on that front seven. The worry for Rutgers is the defensive back end. Can they contain Syracuse throwing the football?
Justin Dorner with the kick. And the Big East season is underway. Kabina at the 4-yard line. He's up to the 20. He's hit, and he's hit hard. Return of 16 on the play. Lorenzo Waters coming up to make the stop of the kickoff coverage team. And well, here's Ryan Nassib now hitting 71.4% of his passes, and he should go over 1,000 in this game.
Well, what we talked about, Mike, is his touchdown to interceptions, 9 touchdowns and only 1 interception on the season. He has control. He shows poise in the pocket. And today, he's going to have to take a look. If the number one guy isn't there, he may have to use his legs a little bit more from inside the pocket.
Antoine Bailey's in the backfield after rushing for 114 in that overtime victory against Toledo last week. There's Tom Zach, our Big East officiating crew, and first play from scrimmage now for Syracuse. Bailey gets the call, and Bailey's up over the 30-yard line, has to get to the 32, but a nice gain as he picks up 8 on the play. Let's take a look at the starting lineup now. The backs and receivers. Alec Lemon, just 1 catch last week, but it was the go-ahead touchdown. He went over 1,000 yards last week. And the offensive line.
They're calling this a fumble, Mike.
Tiller, Hay, Chabane, and Pugh have combined for 74 starts. So Bailey gets the call. He coughs up the football, and it's going to be Rutgers' ball. Jamal Morrell, the sophomore linebacker, comes up with it.
They're going to definitely take a look at this. This is a huge hole by Syracuse, doing a good job up front. Antoine Bailey, let's take another look and see if that football looks like it comes out from the grasp. He had it tucked with his left arm, and that ball's on the ground. Rutgers comes up with the football. Just at the end of this play, it looked like a helmet on the football at the end of the play. The ball's loose right there, the helmet coming from the back end. And that ball's on the ground. It looks like Syracuse comes up with it.
Jack Kramer is our replay official up in the booth.
Jamal Merrill, the linebacker, he puts his helmet right on the football of Antoine Bailey from the backside. You can see Bailey does not have the football when his knee hit.
At first, I thought the ground might have caused it, but you're right. The ball is definitely loose.
It pops out right there. Hits another Syracuse player and then back into the arm of Jamal Merrill.
So Jack Kramer's upstairs looking for indisputable video evidence. I think we saw it right there, but we'll see if he agrees. That's Tom Zach, the referee. Antoine Bailey with 28 carries, 114 yards a week ago. This is his first carry right here, and there's the ball.
There's the ball right there. It hits in the stomach of one of the defensive backs for Rutgers, and then it goes back to the man who caused the fumble, Jamal Merrill.
Of course, a week ago we had a very controversial call on a missed extra point.
I was going to say
they did not overturn.
We just did this, Mike.
This was the first play from scrimmage, and we go upstairs with Jack Kramer. Tom Zach now will make the call, looking for indisputable video evidence. So it stands. So there was no indisputable video evidence to reverse that call.
Again, a huge hole down the middle of the football field, and a great play by Merrill, the linebacker, gets his helmet right on the football and then is able, he causes the fumble and has the fumble recovery. Now you have a sudden change. Anytime you have sudden change, look for a big play down the field.
First play from scrimmage now. The Scarlet Knights, great field position. And Dodd wants to go to work. Goes upstairs, and this one is incomplete. Juwan Jameson came out of the backfield. Now that last call, John, was stands. But I would think that would be confirmed because the video evidence confirmed that there was a fumble.
Right, they called the fumble on the field. And here's the first play for Rutgers, a pretty good throw. He wanted to get that on the back shoulder, Chase Dodd did, to his running back, Jameson, who's only a freshman, 5'8", so a tough catch on that wheel route.
Jamison getting the start after rushing for 97 yards in a backup role last week. Oh! Ball is loose! Can you believe that hit? Rashard Anderson takes it the distance. 65 yards! Unbelievable!
You want to talk about a collision in the backfield. Rashard Anderson did the easy work, the scoop and run. What a hit by Syracuse's defense. We talked about the pressure they would bring to the line of scrimmage, both defenses. That's just a devastating hit in the backfield. Dyshawn Davis, the freshman out of Woodbury, New Jersey, comes up with the big hit and scoop and run for six.
Ross Kroutman on for the extra points. No doubt about this one, right down the middle. Although he said he made that one last week against Toledo too. What a start to this football game.
Davis with a huge hit, and then Rashard Anderson, the scoop and score. He has a great escort by Philip Thomas, but just a devastating hit by Davis. That young linebacker gets 3 or 4 yards in the Syracuse backfield. Nobody touches him. And then the awareness of Anderson to scoop and score. He had the escort of Philip Thomas, but they come right back after dropping the football, laying it on the carpet on offense. The defense sets the tone with a huge hit by Dyshawn Davis.
How did Davis get in that backfield so quickly?
That offensive line's asking that same question on the sideline. Somebody misses the linebacker on that stunt. Looked like the right guard closed down, and Davis just filled that gap with speed and tenacity.
Rashard Anderson getting the start at cornerback because Keon Lynn has a banged up shoulder. He takes it 65 yards, saying, hey, this isn't so tough. I kind of enjoy playing. So Kroutman will kick off with a 7-0 lead here in the Big East opener.
No lack of excitement, Mike, to start this on both offenses. They both turn it over, but Syracuse does a great job of turning the turnover into a touchdown.
Kick taken over the 10-yard line. Daring all the way over the 40 up to the 42. A 29-yard return by Jeremy Daring. Daring, the sophomore out of Tampa, Florida, last year in the Wildcats. He caught balls, he ran balls, and coming off a concussion now, they're expecting him slowly come back into it, and he had a big game against Syracuse last year.
166 yards on 29 attempts last year. He's just slowly coming back from an injury in the summer, in the practices. He had a concussion, but he's the home run threat on special teams and once he gets his hands on the football in that backfield.
Certainly passes the eye test, as so many of these offensive players for Rutgers do. There's some movement on the left side. And Chase Dodd says, slow down, guys.
I'll start. 66 offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
66 offense. That's Andre Civil, a sophomore out of Brooklyn, New York. Very young offensive line for Greg Schiano. Civil's a sophomore. Desmond Wins, a senior. They've got another sophomore and a couple of freshmen up front. We'll check that lineup in a minute. First and 15. It's Martinick, the second leading receiver, the former running back and fullback. Slips a tackle, still on his feet inside the 40-yard line. They say Martinick doesn't get many carries at fullback, but when he gets his hands on the football, he remembers he was a one-time running back.
He's very unselfish, and this is the luxury of offensive coordinator Frank Cignetti. He allows to go ahead and go empty in that backfield if he wants, because he has a fullback that was once a tailback, so he can catch the football and he runs like a tailback. So it's a great situation for Rutgers, breaking tackles on the outside and getting instant field position after that big play that was given up just moments ago.
Gain of 25 on the play. First down, Scarlet Knights. That's Jamison, the redshirt freshman from Stark, Florida. Let's take a look at the Scarlet Knights offensively now. Backs and receivers. We mentioned the fact that Sanu leads the nation with 12 catches a game, but Mark Harrison had 44 last year. Only three coming into the game this afternoon. They're waiting for him to break loose. And up front, keep an eye on the right side. Bateem Bajari is a redshirt freshman. Caleb Johnson, a true freshman, both getting their first starts last week, and Greg Schiano says both are very explosive football players. Dive fires incomplete, and the intended receiver was Caron Pratt, the and defensively now for Syracuse. Up front, Marinovich making his 30th consecutive start. Deion Goggins, a senior, first-time starter. Four tackles for loss, 22 tackles from that nose guard position. Marquis Spruill did not get the start because of an injury last week. He's back in the starting lineup. And the injury-riddled secondary. Jeremy Wilkes starting again at safety. Shamarco Thomas is out. And Rashard Anderson starting for Keon Lynn. We already saw Rashard Anderson go 65 yards with a touchdown. Third down. Pratt, the intended receiver, Dodd overshoots him, but again, pressure up front. But now by number 91, Brandon Sharp.
Brandon Sharp and Mikhail Marinovich, those two guys are going to get an opportunity to go against young offensive linemen on the right side. Good pressure, but plenty of time to make an accurate throw to a wide-open receiver on the edge. That time, Chase Dodd would love to have that one back just a little bit lower, make it an easy pitch and catch.
Santee with 50 career field goals on to try a 51-yarder. And it's up. Well, it was going to be long enough. It hit the upright, so it's no good from 51. Now for Syracuse. Tombe Kose and Antoine Bailey in the backfield. As Nassib goes under center, Bailey up over the 35, and turnovers key early, John.
Very key early. On the first play, Antoine Bailey props it up, and Jamal Merrill gets the hit and the fumble recovery, so very disappointing for Syracuse, but they come right back on the enormous hit by Dyshawn Davis and the scoop and score by Rashard Anderson, the junior from Miramar, Florida. He gets the escort from Philip Thomas, 65 yards for the score.
You sure there wasn't a trap door there?
I know.
Dyshawn Davis coming through. Good pressure. And wisely, Nassib throws it away. Nassib trying to rally the troops, looking at that offensive line and say, where'd they come from?
Well, we talked about his awareness in the second year in the offense and feeling comfortable. We showed you the play last week where he was able to find Nick Provo. That play is not going to show up on any stat line, but that was a good job of getting rid of the football without intentional grounding and still staying in a third and manageable situation instead of third and very long.
Syracuse 39% success rates converting third downs. Some movement on the left side. It looked like a Justin Pugh, the junior from Holland, Pennsylvania, moved.
Ball start, 67 offense, 5-yard penalty, third down.
So it's still third down, but a third and a little bit longer. That's Wayne Warren, the junior from Salisbury, Maryland, a backup safety for Greg Schiano. You mentioned last year the 13-10 ball game, a very hard hitting affair. Obviously, that's going to be the case here today as well.
It's always a situation when these two teams get together. We're going to take a look and see if we can get the right here. That's the helmet to the leg, it looked like. And possibly when he came down, he may have injured that right hand, because he came down quite awkwardly on it. You see him shaking his right arm or right hand or wrist.
Warren was on a safety blitz and Antoine Bailey picked it up after getting chewed out by his quarterback on the previous play.
Always good just to let him know you're there. Now Greg Schiano in an advantageous position with third and very long, third and 13. They love to pressure the line of scrimmage and bring an exotic blitz to try to force a turnover, which has happened so far on the other side of the football.
Hey, John, right now let's take a look at the Principal Financial Group edge to the game. Rutgers defense first.
Well, head coach Greg Schiano told us yesterday they want to play fast and restrict daylight in that running game. And so far, they've done a pretty good job forcing a turnover. On the other side of the football, Syracuse would love to exploit the pressure. Offensive coordinator Nathaniel Hackett, he said if the head coach is going to be calling the plays on the Rutgers sideline for their defense, he takes pride in going up against their best and trying to match wits with the head coach and Greg Schiano.
Nassib and company facing a third and 13. Out of the gun, Bailey's in the backfield with Nassib. Here comes the blitz. There's the big tight end, Provo. Stays on his feet and gets pushed out of bounds just shy of the 40-yard line. So they get some of the yardage back, but that'll set up a punting situation.
And, Mike, you can see on third down, head coach Greg Schiano brought some heat up the middle with linebacker pressure, brought some edge pressure towards the screen, and was able to get off the field on third down. So that's a good situation for Rutgers, getting three and out from their defense.
And a week ago, we saw Jonathan Fisher, the freshman, punt for Syracuse. And now Shane Raupers, the junior, will get the start. He gets it off a little bit quicker. He goes off the side of his foot and certainly takes a Syracuse bounce. All the way inside the 15-yard line. It's going to be downed at the 10. Anselmo said yesterday, you know what? If they took the point off the board, who's to say we don't play defense differently on that Toledo drive?
That's true.
Jameson thought he saw a hole and he stood up by a host of blue jerseys. Jeremy Wilkes making initial contact. He picks up one. So we take a look at the edges to the game. Rutgers on offense, John.
Rutgers, they need to catch the football. Head coach Greg Schiano said there's too many drops, excluding Mohamed Sanu. They need to get that percentage up with the quarterback. And defensively, Scott Schaefer, they want to stop the Rutgers go-to plays. That's that zone read run or that weak side run. They need to stop it. So far, they've done a nice job.
Jameson in motion. Dye flips it out to Martinick again. Big fullback puts his head down. And he's alone up near the 20-yard line. Kevin Scott finally pushes him out of bounds. They're going to move the chains after a 10-yard gain.
We've talked about Mohamed Sanu in the open and how dangerous he is. But so far, Joe Martinick, the tailback converted into the fullback, has been doing damage. Very short catches, but the run after catch, he runs like a running back. And when Rutgers goes to a one-back set, he'll dot it back there, and they're doing it right now.
Syracuse showing blitz. Here they come. Martinick gets the call. He's wrestled down at about the 22. Eric Kroom, the true freshman from Detroit, makes the stop.
Mike, both of these offenses are very similar. And probably when you take a look across the Big East Conference, these two offenses, there's no high tempo, there's no high octane, there's no spread you out. They like to run the football, and they like to win the battle at the line of scrimmage. And they figure as the season goes on, we have to prove how tough we are at the line of scrimmage. They won't fool anybody with exotic formations, but they do like to run the football in between the tackles.
Great points. I'm going to add to that right after this play. Dot out of the gun, flips it out again to Martinick, and that's his third catch already. Up near the 30, has to get to the 31 for the first down. Rashard Anderson makes the stop. He picks up 7. On that, what you just said, John, a caveat on top of that, you have Nathaniel Hackett, Frank Signetti, the two offensive coordinators in this game, both with NFL backgrounds.
And I think it helps it because you can get into multiple formations and still run your base offense.
Penalty flag down. This one's batted at the line of scrimmage. That was Mikhail Marinovich.
Offside, 91 defense, 5-yard penalty, results in a first down.
Ooh, tough one. Brandon Sharp offside for Syracuse. And that's going to give Rutgers a first down. Doug Marone, you could just see his body English there, not too happy.
Yeah, they felt like the defense was going to get off the field on that third down opportunity, and now Rutgers gets a fresh set of downs. And I'd probably like to see them go to Sanu really quickly here on first down, try to get a one-on-one matchup.
Jameson dots the eye, gets the call. Running hard up to the 35-yard line. Now, Syracuse has not allowed a 100-yard rusher yet this year. And Jameson with 97 last year, he flirted with a 100-yard game.
And Mike, Syracuse committing 9 people to the line of scrimmage within a 4-yard box, and they left Mohamed Sanu outside one-on-one. I expect Chase Dodd, if he sees that look again anytime in this football game, to get out of the run, check out of that running play, and try to go to the best player on the field wearing number 6 in white.
He's not too bad. There he is. Mohamed Sanu. Lined up at the bottom of your screen. Dodd, quick release, and could have been picked off. You see, Jeremy Wilkes wanted to lay the lumber out, but if he would have kept his head up, that would have been INT.
Good job by the Rutgers offense trying to push the issue, but a better job by the defensive backs. And there's the disparity with Mohamed Sanu, 36 receptions, but everybody else in single digits. They haven't gone to Sanu yet today.
Third down play. Dodd fires, and it's grabbed. Pulled down by number 81, Mark Harrison, 17 on the play. So Harrison has had some drops this year. 9 touchdowns, 44 catches last year. Greg Schiano said he's trying to make the big play, just has to execute. Everything will be fine.
He's an explosive athlete, good patience in the pocket, and there's a lot of blue jerseys in that square down the middle of the football field. But Dodd's able to fit the football in, and great size going up to get the football.
Receivers athletic and huge. Dodd looking for him right now, right down the middle, going for the home run ball, and some miscommunication. As Kevin Scott said, hang up there just another second and I'll go get it. Now, if you're playing defensive back, look at the size of these receivers, John.
It looks like an NFL defensive front. Mohamed Sanu's got great size at 6'2", 215, but he's the smallest guy out there. You've got Jefferson at 6'6", at tight end, right at wide receiver at 6'4", 221. Harrison, who made that acrobatic catch, at 6'3", 230. So you've got size. If you're Dodd, you just want to get it close because these guys have a great chance to come down with the football.
9th play of the drive started way back on their own 10-yard line. Jamison's got some running room this time. Bounces off a would-be tackler all the way down to about the 42-yard line. Picks up 6. Torrey Ball making the stop. You know, that graphic, I noticed it's at Brandon Coleman at the bottom, 6'6", 220. They say he was a double-double machine in basketball, so he's very athletic.
Yeah, high school All-American and the McDonald's player in that game. So it's a situation where they have athletes on the perimeter.
Third down. Good defensive play. Tyshawn Davis, the freshman linebacker, again number 35. And Syracuse is going to call a timeout.
Syracuse called their first timeout before the play was off.
Oh, before the play.
Wow. And that's twice now in this drive. You had Brandon Sharp lining up in the neutral zone that on third down to extend a drive. And now you think you're going to get off the field for the second time. And Doug Marone, you can see it in his face, not happy with this defense because they're stopping themselves defensively.
I'm not sure if I heard a whistle before the play, but the timeout was called before the ball was snapped.
I still haven't heard a whistle.
I didn't either. Now, Syracuse on the season, only 6 penalties a game on average, about 62 yards.
And Doug Marone on that sideline trying to plead his case to the official, but third down situations, you have to get off the football field. Syracuse thought they did twice, but now giving another opportunity for Rutgers to make a play.
Dodd's going to work with an empty backfield, but under center. Mohamed Sanu inside the 40, had to get down to the 38. He's going to be shy, picks up 3, needed 4. And that might be Sanu's first carry this year, John.
It was a nice play call to get him to the outside in space. A big athlete at 6'2", 215. But a better job of Syracuse rallying to the football. This looked like it was going to go for at least 5 or 10 yards. But a good job of Syracuse setting the edge outside and making Sanu cut back to where all the help was coming from in the middle of the football field.
So Justin Dorner, the junior college transfer from Redondo Beach, is on to punt it. See what kind of hang time he gets here, because it should pin Syracuse deep in their territory. Now he's going to have a little more room to operate with, as there's some jumping and movement going on. Patrick Kivlihan.
All start. 47 offense. 5-yard penalty. Fourth down.
Both coaches trying to plead their case on timeouts and penalties. It looked like Syracuse may have moved first. But as you said, Rutgers gets the 5-yarder and backs up their special teams unit.
Stephen Rene standing back at the 10-yard line. And now Dorner will get this one away about the 45. High end over end. Rene with the fair catch. Just over the 10-yard line. Nassib, 9 touchdowns, 1 pick. The same as Geno Smith and Zach Collaros. Antoine Bailey in the backfield as Nassib goes under center this time. Bailey gets the call up over the 11 up to the 12, a gain of 2. There's number 20. Kasim Green, former safety, playing linebacker now.
Second down and 8. This Rutgers defense, Mike, very physical at the point of attack. They like to get a lot of red helmets around the football. And you can see these guys pre-snap, showing blitz, moving around, making it very difficult for the orange offensively to really know who they're going to block in their assignments up front.
Green, one of 13 players to change their position, trying to get this defense faster. Nassib dumps it out to his big tight end, Provo. Provo picks up the first down. Greg Schiano said that they actually recruited him out of Florida, and they backed off. It was probably a mistake. They should have stayed on him. Let's take a look at the Scarlet Knight defense right now. We talk about the 13 players changing positions. Manny Abreu, former linebacker, now he's a defensive end. And you look at the linebackers, Kasim Green, a former safety, now playing linebacker, leads the team with 23 tackles. And in the secondary, Daron Harmon with 3 INTs. David Rowe, a former cornerback, now playing safety for Rutgers. NASA. Van Chu overshoots him. Ball's incomplete. Thought it was interesting, John, that Shiano had 13 player moves, but definitely playing a lot faster than they did last year.
They're trying to get to the football. That time, Ryan Nassib was trying to take advantage of his speed on the offensive side. Van Chu and Alec Lemon were going deep, and he missed Chu down the middle of the football field. He had Lemon towards his own sideline, so good job by offensive coordinator Nathaniel Hackett of, after grinding it out, getting it to his tight end, trying to go deep down the field for a big, big play on first down.
Second and 10 from the 24. Nassib gets it out quickly. And it's complete to the big fullback. Adam Harris picks up 12. Penalty flag dropped at about the 30. Logan Ryan makes the defensive stop. Harris, one of the captains of the Syracuse team.
An eligible receiver downfield. 85 offense. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
Penalties really hurting Syracuse twice on defense and getting off the field, and now they have a positive play offensively. Beckett Wales trying to get outside. He must be covered up by the outside receiver in number 15, Alec Lemon. But that was a nice pitch and catch by quarterback going to the outside to his fullback, Adam Harris. 3 penalties now for 15 yards for the Orange.
Nassib. Well, he checked down. Finally finds Bailey out in the flat. And he's run down just over the 20-yard line. Watching Ryan Nassib that time, his eyes were checking all over the field.
Huh? Yeah, he was very careful with the football, and I think he made a pretty good decision because he had an opportunity to maybe squeeze one down the field, but he did check it. He checked it down. He checked it backwards to his running back. And Antoine Bailey just to get a positive play, but a good decision on second and long. Didn't want to force the issue down deep in his own end.
Third and 12.
And this is a situation where Jared West last week had 2 big catches on third and long.
Nassib steps up, felt some pressure, and got rid of it. And Van Chu looked up, and the ball was already whizzing by his ear.
Nassib stepped up and threw the fastball to his playmaker, his deep threat, Van Chu. Good stepping up into the pocket. That's exactly the way you coach it. You just want to take a little bit off. At that point, Mike, you just want to play pitch and catch and make it a throw in his chest.
Raupers. It's off of Boomer. Sanu calls for the fair catch, and he is drifting backwards near the 35. A 40-yard punt that time. And let's take a look at Mohamed Sanu, who's the real deal, brought to you by Wendy's.
He was the real deal last week. 16 receptions, 176 yards, and 2 touchdowns, all career highs. He went crazy against Ohio University. And you know what? He hasn't been targeted really one time. He has 0 receptions and had that one handoff on the end around. So I would look to see Mohamed Sanu get into this offense on this series, especially if they get an opportunity to match him up man-to-man on the outside.
Think of all the receivers in the Big East, huh? Over at Pittsburgh, or even Kenny Britt at Rutgers.
Right.
No one had 16 catches before.
It's amazing.
Jamison trying to get something rolling offensively now. He rumbles up over the 40-yard line. Gain of 5 on the play. Shiano saying that this young man, the redshirt freshman from Florida, has great vision and good feet.
And he's a thick guy, too. You know, not big in stature at 5'8", 198, but he runs very heavy behind his pads. He missed 12 days of camp, so it slowed him down a little bit, but he had 29 carries last week.
6 for 15 so far here this afternoon. Was his 7th carry. It's a Syracuse wall just over the line of scrimmage. 29 carries you mentioned, John, last week. He said in high school at the bowl school down in Florida, he probably had 15 max in a game.
He was out of the game by the third quarter because they were beating up on people at the bowl school. But now is a different situation when he takes the next step from high school to college football.
Against Ohio University last week, Rutgers was 11 of 18 on third down. Sanu's 1 for 3.
Sanu's in the slot. You got to get him in a zone and get the football to him.
There he is, Sanu. He's got the first down and then some. Inside the 40-yard line. Finally tripped up by Marquise Spruill, the middle linebacker.
Good patience by Chase Dodd, the quarterback for Rutgers. He sat in the pocket. He let Sanu come in and then back out. And good accuracy with the football. He breaks a tackle. Remember, we talked about the size of these Rutgers receivers. They're huge. Sanu, 6'2", 215. He's going to break an arm tackle. You have to wrap him up. A gain of 18. A good conversion by Dodd and Sanu.
Dodd goes upstairs again. This time overshoots his fullback, Martinick. This Rutgers offense with 410 yards against Ohio University last week. And the reason I bring that up is Ohio U had allowed 247 per game up until Rutgers exploded last week.
Yeah, Dodd got just a touch greedy on that one. He had his first look in the flat. Andre Sybil, the left tackle, down for Rutgers, but he wanted to throw the football to the flat, thinking he would look there and then flash to the curl route, but it never came open.
Sybil, the starting left tackle, a sophomore from Brooklyn, New York. Greg Schiano saying if one of his tackles go out, Desmond Stapleton, a backup on the right side, would probably move over to the left. Stapleton, a starter last year and a senior, had to be an eye-opening experience as a senior last week watching a true freshman take your job.
Yeah, Bujari up front at the right side guard and then Johnson at the right tackle. You're right, Michael.
The next Saturday on the Big East Network Game of the Week, Lyle McCombs and the UConn Huskies head into Morgantown to take on Geno Smith and the Mountaineers of West Virginia. The action starts at noon Eastern. Check your local listings.
Geno Smith, get some rest. He's got a tough one today. They play Bowling Green, a 3-1 Bowling Green team. But Geno Smith, he tied that Big East record last week with 65 attempts.
Yeah, mentioning Bowling Green at 3-1. How about Toledo last week? We were impressed with them. Temple right now almost knocked off Penn State. They drilled
Maryland. Yeah,
and they're playing Toledo. So the Mid-American Conference, very impressive up to this juncture as Andre Sybil leaves the field.
Second down and 10 from the 38-yard line.
Greg Schiano, career started as a GA at Rutgers, a GA at Penn State, and Went on to be a defensive back coach for Joe Pa at Penn State, then the Chicago Bears, defensive coordinator at Miami. Now's the head coach. He's calling the defensive shots again here for Rutgers this year. Dodd fires. Oh! Sanu with a one-handed grab. Did he stay in bounds? Yes, they're going to say it's a completed ball. That, my friends, is a big-time catch.
And that's something we have, you know, shouldn't be shocked. We saw that in the open against North Carolina, the one-handed, right-handed catch. This one is just spectacular. And the quarterback gives Sanu an opportunity to go up with one hand and get 1 foot down. This is just a great placement of the football and a better catch by Mohamed Sanu. He gets that left foot down.
Mentioned his 16 catches last week. He's had 29 the last 2 weeks.
Going on the previous play was a completed pass. The play is under further review.
Well, they're going back upstairs, and Jack Kramer will take a look at this one. It's ruled a completed ball. We'll see if they overturn it.
Would sure look like a catch to me. Dodd on the run. He has good protection. Sanu in that little window to the outside. He gets that left hand up there. He has the left foot down. And it looks like he controlled the football to the ground. Good job of going up. Great concentration. I believe that's a catch.
The 16 grabs last week. Number two in the nation, Robert Woods from Southern Cal at 17 against Minnesota earlier this year. Sanu now with two catches, 30 yards. He was saying, you know, dinged up last year, John. He really enjoys just going to the wide receiver meetings and listening to coach P.J. Fleck, because he really wants to learn how to be a true wide receiver.
Well, you know, not only one injury with the leg, but he had a shoulder injury as well. And, you know, that really stunted his growth as a wide receiver. But this year, 100% healthy, and he's made some spectacular catches. We talked about
the ruling on the field is confirmed.
We talked about the one against North Carolina down in Chapel Hill. Now he makes one in the dome. He's a zone buster. He's a man buster. He's a big guy that is strong with the football, but yet he's smooth in and out of routes.
So they go upstairs, and Jack Kramer confirms it. The video evidence confirmed that he had that foot down. And of course, last week after the missed extra point that was ruled a make, Terry McCauley, the supervisor of officials in the Big East, later issued the statement saying that that was an incorrect call. They should have took that point off the board. Jamison looking for a hole. Doesn't really materialize. He gets inside the 25-yard line. Let's take a look at our Big East leaders brought to you by PNC for the Achiever in You. And as we mentioned, Mohamed Sanu, 12 catches a game. That's number one in the country.
Well, the Big East has been slinging the football, and you can see Tavon Austin at 7.8 receptions per game, Alex Lemon in this football game, and then a couple of Mountaineers with Bailey and McCartney. So guys in West Virginia, Syracuse, and Rutgers catching the football in the Big East Conference.
12 catches a game, 29-2. That's a season for a lot of receivers. They'd be happy
pretty
with that.
Pretty good average, wouldn't you say, Mike? I can count on number 6 or 12 a game. That's pretty good. Your odds of winning go through the roof when that happens.
You know, talk about some of the good receivers that Greg Schiano has had, though. He had 16 catches last week. How about Kenny Britt back in 2007? He had 176 yards against Syracuse on 6 catches.
Big play guy.
On 6 catches.
He has an opportunity right now, too, with press coverage. Another big play opportunity.
Dodd feeling the pressure. He's going down. Again, it's number 35, Dyshon Davis, the true freshman. First sack of the afternoon. That's number 9 for Scott Schaefer's defense this year.
Great pressure off the edge. A big playmaker. Davis comes in. He has the big hit in the game, and now he has the first sack of the football game.
And that's got 65 yards on that touchdown by Rashard Anderson. Their offense in the first quarter, just 33 total yards. Dodd steps up and almost picked off. Then Cameron Lynch, who had 8 tackles last week, didn't see this one coming.
A little pressure in the backfield. Brandon Sharp and Diabate from that linebacker position. They do a good job of forcing Dodd to throw the football a little bit quicker than he wanted to or anticipated. Sanu maybe coming out of that break a little bit slower. Sanu was well to the inside, and very lucky for Rutgers that was not picked off.
Here's Sansanti. He's missed from 51. He hit the upright. This one is from 47. He pulled it. So the senior from North Carolina is 0 for 2 here this afternoon.
Coach Chiano talking to his veteran kicker. The first one he hit well from 51. That one looked left the minute he touched the football.
Take a look at our Ameriprise Financial Big East headlines right now. The Big East school presidents to meet in Washington, D.C. and a president's meeting only on Sunday. Of course, Pittsburgh rolling over USF on Thursday night. And as you mentioned, Mohamed Sanu having a record-breaking game last week against Ohio University. Provo again. This is his third catch for the tight end today. He's up over the 35-yard line. Marcus Cooper makes the stop. Susan Herbst, the UConn president, this is a comment, a quote she said about that meeting on Sunday. The Big East presidents have been engaged in frequent communication by phone or in person. They're committed together to make the Big East work, to make it stronger in spite of the announcement that Syracuse and Pittsburgh will leave to go to the ACC. A lot of reports saying that UConn wanted to join them in the ACC, so... interesting comment there. Interesting statement. Although she said, "Don't pay attention to those rumors." So
Syracuse is charged with their second timeout.
So Syracuse now with just one timeout remaining here in the first half as they use up their second.
Orange is a different story.
Nassib under center with Bailey behind him. Syracuse trying to protect a 7-0 lead and add to it. This is Bailey. Second down play, had to get to the 40 for the first down. Just shy of that, picked up two.
Mike, offensively right now, if you're Syracuse, you want to take this ball and take it for about 5 minutes. And you want to start to control this game and maybe make it a two-score game. They have to convert on third down first. Stay onside, no penalties. But they want to try to take over the momentum of this game because it's right now it's anybody's football game. You want to make a statement on this drive.
And keep that young, injury-riddled Syracuse defense off the field. Third and shorts. It's going to be a fourth and short. What do you do? You're at the 40-yard line, fourth down and inches. What do you do, John?
Boy, that's a tough. You're going to punt the football, but that's a tough call and a tough throw to make on third and inches to get your tailback on a wheel route. I know that's probably the second or third option he had on that play for Ryan Nassib, but I don't agree with dropping back on third and inches. You have to let your offensive lineman win that battle up front.
Ralpers on to kick it. Ralpers, a one-time scholarship player, left the program, came back as a walk-on. And Sanu catches it on the run, gets just shy of the 35. A 30-yard punt, 4-yard return for Mohamed Sanu. Dorian Graham, the receiver, coming up to make the tackle on the punt coverage team.
I wouldn't be surprised at all now after getting... you know, coming your defense, getting them off the field for Rutgers if there's a little bit of play action on first down and trying to hit the big play. You've got Mohamed Sanu on the outside. You've got Mark Harrison, who's an explosive athlete. Maybe on first down, try to get a little play down the field.
Well, the second quarter's been a big quarter for the Scarlet Knights. Jamison, nowhere to go. Loss on the play. They say Rutgers in the second quarter outscoring the opposition 40-13, but this dinged up defense playing pretty well here today.
Well, when you win the battle at the line of scrimmage, you're going to win a lot of football games. First player there is Jay Bromley on the bottom of that pile from Jamaica, New York. He made an excellent play, good athleticism. He's a big body down there at 6'3", 280 pounds. You need to win those battles more than not. And up front, it's going to be tough all day because both of these teams like to get after it.
Loss of two, so it's second and 12. Here they come. He gets the pass off, and it just falls shy of Sanu. Spruill. He was in there putting on the heat, along with a few of his comrades.
Defensive coordinator Scott Schaefer dialing up the pressure on second and long. He brings Marquise Spruill right down the middle. He was blocked initially, but a great effort now forcing Rutgers into a third and long situation. They've been throwing it under, 2 of 5 on third downs. They've been dumping it off and relying on run after catch in these situations.
There's a stop in the shotgun. It's a little bit high. The ball is loose. Syracuse save. They have it. David Osa, the sophomore center, snapped it just a little bit high. And Dodd had a jump for it, and by the time he got control, I guess he never did get control.
Yeah, Torrey Ball looked like he was on the football. A high snap. Dodd tries to make the athletic catch, but can't come up with it on the bottom of that pile. Martinick for Rutgers was down there as well. But Torrey Ball gets the fumble recovery. He's got a sack and a half on the season, but a bigger play now. Instant field position for Syracuse in their offense.
So Syracuse came into the game. They forced 6 fumbles, but only recovered 1. That's their second fumble recovery here. First one went for a touchdown, and now they have great field position at the 26-yard line.
And this is where Jared West loved to go down the middle of the field.
Nassib. This one's picked off. Justin Francis. Wow, this is like a backyard pickup game right now. Justin Francis, 6'4", 275-pound defensive tackle. He comes in with 13 and a half career sacks. He kind of stretched up there and grabbed the INT that time.
You want to talk about an athletic play by a defensive lineman. Justin Francis, watch the stretch. We talked about the size of the wide receivers. Francis is 6'4". He goes and climbs the ladder and gets the interception. His first of the year.
He knew that was coming, didn't he?
Yeah, he read it all the way.
So why are all these blue jerseys down here? I think they're setting up a screen.
Great recognition by Justin Francis.
So just like that, Greg Schiano's offense back on the field. 2 turnovers each here. Scott Schaefer showing blitz again. Here they come. This one's complete. Harrison up over the 40 for a first down. Picks up 13 on the play. So Rutgers comes in averaging 36 points a game. Here's what's transpired offensively for them so far. Fumble, a missed field goal.
Yeah, not very successful. Punting it was probably the most successful thing they've done offensively, but now they have momentum back. Only down by 7, under 12 minutes left to go before halftime. If Dodd can get hot, they can tie this up right here on this set of downs.
And that's Savon Huggins, that big-time recruit, getting his first carry, a true freshman from New Jersey. Picks up 4. There's a penalty flag dropped very late back at the 39.
They're going to get Brandon Sharp for a
dead ball.
Personal foul.
91 defense. 15-yard penalty. First down.
Ooh, Doug Marone's not happy. That's the second time that number 91 Brandon Sharp's been penalized. But this is a biggie.
You don't want to give it to Rutgers. You have to make them earn it offensively. DC Jefferson, the tight end, was tangled up with him, and it looks like a kick at the end by DC Jefferson, but that was he threw the flag on Brandon Sharp, so that might have been offsetting, I would think, at the worst.
Sharp could have said, I was just trying to get up. I was using his leg. Huggins again slips off the first tackler. Not so successful against Danny Vaughn, the linebacker. Savon Huggins, the true freshman, probably the biggest recruit for Greg Schiano. He's had some pretty good talent there at Rutgers. Number one recruit in New Jersey.
Huggins is one of those running backs that just needs to slow everything down. I think he's trying to get that 60-yard run when there's a 6-yard run available. Just slow everything down and take what's there.
Well, Huggins takes it again, puts his head down, and slips through. Inside the 35-yard line, Dyshon Davis making the stop. He picks up three more. Savon Huggins scored twice in his collegiate debut, but he also, in his first start last week, fumbled twice. And that's where Jawan Jamison stepped in. Third down and five. Huggins is split to the bottom of your screen now, wide. This one's complete. Sanu, first down. Scarlet Knights inside the 25. Mohamed Sanu picks up nine. Jeremy Wilkes defensively for Syracuse.
Just too easy on third down. If you're going to motion Sanu from the short side of the field to the wide side, somebody has to replace. But there's nobody in the frame. Just an easy pitch and catch from Dodd to Mohamed Sanu. 3 for 39 on the afternoon for big number six on the outside.
Huggins. It's down to about the 22. Danny Vaughn makes the stop from his linebacker spot.
And Mike, now you anticipate pressure if you're offensive coordinator Frank Cignetti. You would think that Scott Schaefer, the defensive coordinator for Syracuse, may want to bring some pressure. So you have big-time, tall receivers on the outside. This might be a jump ball situation where you can get it and use your athleticism, use your height down in the red zone.
Dodd. Nice job of just laying it up there to number five. Tim Wright makes his first stop. Talk about size. He's 6'4", about 220. He might be the forgotten guy in this receiving corps.
Yeah, he's one of those guys that only has four catches coming in to this game for 32 yards and a touchdown. But he's a dependable guy. He's one of those guys that's coming along. He's had a couple drops, but he's getting better with each day. And head coach Greg Schiano says he just needs more repetition. He got one there in the red zone.
Sanu, split to the bottom of your screen. Well, Huggins gets the call. Boy, ran into some heavy traffic, actually bumping into his own player. Let's take a look at how Rutgers is doing in the red zone, John, brought to you by Verizon Wireless.
Well, they came into this game at 81.2% in the red zone. That's seventh in the Big East Conference, 13 of 16 in the red zone, three running touchdowns and six passing, 4 of 5 on field goals. And this is a perfect situation to fit the football into Joe Martinick, the fullback. Short side of the field, you may get a high-low with D.C. Jefferson in the corner. Good situation for a 1-2 punch here.
Second and 11. They swing it out, Martinick, and he's tackled shy of the 10-yard line. Jeremy Wilkes making his second straight start from that safety spot. You know, speaking of red zone defense, though, Syracuse, the opposition, this is the 16th time that they've been in the red zone, but they've only given up six touchdowns.
In the backfield on the offense, 5-yard penalty, second down.
Interesting call. I just saw Martinick back there with Huggins.
Yeah, and I think head coach Doug Marone wants to know, do I have the option of doing anything right there? They're going to...
Correction. Correction. The foul is declined. It'll be third down.
Good call, John.
Yeah, Doug was sauntering down there to the official saying, wait a minute, guys. You didn't ask. I want to decline that penalty. So now it'll bring up a third down situation for Rutgers. If your defense right now with Syracuse, look at number six, Mohamed Sanu. He's in the slot up top. But before that, Rutgers may want to talk it over.
Rutgers has called their first
timeout. They've just called their first timeout, so they will talk it over. They don't want another missed opportunity. San Santee's missed twice on field goals so far here this afternoon from 51 and 47. So Greg Schiano, you talk about that running game. Jamison with 97 yards last week. They were only averaging about 76 yards moving the football on the ground, but that bumped up to 95 against North Carolina, and they barely lost to the Tar Heels, but they only had 1 yard on 25 carries.
Yeah, that was a situation. If they got anything out of their running game, they would probably would have won that game on the road. But you like to see what Greg Schiano did in the offseason. He went out and hired Frank Cignetti, the offensive coordinator from Pitt, and he does what they used to do at Rutgers. That's what he brought in from Pittsburgh. A little bit of everything. He does a good job of formationing you, of spreading the football around. He has a competent quarterback in Chase Dodd that likes the new offense. He feels confident in the new offense. But right now, you've got to take a look at number six. In this situation, third and goal, 7:35 left to go before halftime. You have an opportunity to tie this football game up. Sanu's the guy that's been running that little drag route. He's in the slot up at the top of the screen. That's where my attention would go if I was wearing an orange helmet.
How about Coleman, number 17, 6'6", 220, can jump out of the building. But definitely looking for Sanu. Incomplete. Dom Onena in coverage.
Just a little wheel route by Sanu. A great job by Onena running as a linebacker, and then he gets some help from Wilkes over the top. So they had double coverage on a play that's thrown from the right hash to the left corner of the end zone. Tough play to complete.
San Santee from 27. If he gets it, it'll be his first today, but his 51st of his career. There it is, number 51. And Greg Schiano's on the board here in the first half.
Turn up the heat again with that defensive front. This is going to be a struggle all day. It's going to be a battle of big plays. Syracuse trying to do something to change the field position on special teams. Rutgers trying to be tougher with that front seven on the defensive front.
Justin Dorner, the junior out of California, ready to kick off. Jeremiah Cabina, the true freshman, the deep man for Syracuse. Cabina inside the five, he dropped it. He dropped it, he picked it up, and for a while there, John, I didn't think he'd find the handle. His heart must have been pounding there. Lorenzo Waters making another stop on the kickoff coverage team, a return of 11. Hey, fans, you can win a trip to this year's Beef O'Brady's Bowl with a four-night stay at Trade Ones Resorts on St. Pete's Beach. Premium tickets to the game, access to bowl events, and more. Enter to win at BeefO'Brady'sBowl.com today. First Saturday in October, those bowl games will be coming up in the blink of an eye.
That's right. Be a nice place to spend one in Tampa Bay early for us.
I'm already looking forward to a couple of weeks from now. We'll be down in Tampa.
That's right.
Bailey, a little stutter step. He found a hole on the left side. Picks up a couple on the play. You know, John, last week Nathaniel Hackett talked about how versatile Bailey is. And just you go back to DeLon Carter, 1,200 yards straight ahead, but Carter did not fumble once all season. That's amazing.
And the biggest difference between both those backs are naturally the size, but from last week to this week, Price Tyson Gulley out of the football game with a shoulder injury, so he doesn't have any help with experience in that backfield.
Nassib fumbled the football, and the penalty flags were flying all over the place. It goes against Syracuse.
False start. 10 offense. 5 yard penalty. Second down.
So Doug Marrone, former New Orleans Saints offensive coordinator. 7-3, up by four. And so far it's been a defensive struggle, or a defensive ball game, I should say, for both. And the offenses are struggle, which kind of surprised me. There's a diamond formation down at the bottom of your screen with trips. And this one's complete. Not a whole lot of running room for Jared West, a sophomore from Pennsylvania.
Mike, the one difference between Syracuse's offense and Rutgers, it seems like Rutgers has a 1-2 punch. When they're on third down, they can focus on Mohamed Sanu trying to do something down in the middle of the football field, or Joe Martinick out in the flat. Right now, the identity of Syracuse is the decisions by Ryan Nassib, and I think if you had to pick somebody, it'd be Nick Provo in a situation to rely on a receiver, that tight end position.
Third and nine for Nassib. Leaves the pocket, fires. First down and more. Running all the way up to the midfield stripe. 29 yards on the play for Syracuse. Logan Ryan finally caught up with him and pushed him out of bounds.
Offensive coordinator Nathaniel Hackett calls Alec Lemon, our rack guy, run after catch. He's a guy that can pick him up and put him down, knows how to move the chains after he catches the football. Huge play on third down by this Syracuse offense. Now you'd love to see, after a big play like that, a little play action and try to get somebody over the top.
Bailey. Nothing there. He gets tripped up. The line of scrimmage. Steve Boharnas, the middle linebacker, got his arm on one of his feet, tripped him up.
Speed's been the key word for Rutgers on defense. That's the way they tried to change this defense from last year to this year. 13 players changed positions, and head coach Greg Schiano says we're much faster. Looks like they get to the football with authority.
Says we're faster, but we have to play with more precision. You know, you teach your defensive players to come in with your hands up. Marcus Thompson got his arms up, and Nassib had to change directions. He was going to throw that ball.
Mike, that's one of the plays that offensive coordinator Nathaniel Hackett said, if you go through your progression, you may not have time to get to your third guy. So if you go 1-2 and don't like it, tuck the football and win with your legs.
Syracuse 1-for-4 on third down here this afternoon. Nassib had it and he dropped it. Logan Ryan in coverage. Van Chu rarely drops the football. Last week, or actually, you look at Van Chu, 18 catches this year, 12 have been for a first down or a touchdown, but he dropped this one.
Good coverage, but a better placement of the football always beats good coverage. Ryan Logan had the inside shoulder of Van Chu, but the football was delivered perfectly on the outside shoulder. That was one that should have moved the chains for the Orange.
I think you bring up a good point, though. I think Logan Ryan might have got his hand on it. And Sanu waves his arm for the fair catch just over the 20-yard line with 4 minutes and 5 seconds to go. First and 10 for the Scarlet Knights, trailing by 4. Dodd swings it out, and this one's complete. Number 46, Michael Burton, a redshirt freshman fullback. So Martinick with 3 catches, and now Burton has 1. He picks up 7.
Rutgers spreading the football around today. It was a heavy dose of Mohamed Sanu last week with 16 receptions. But as you said, Mike, a great athletic grab by the backup fullback and Michael Burton. Terrific job of stretching that left hand out and getting control of the football.
It's one thing with Frank Cignetti as offensive coordinator, even at Pittsburgh, like to hit his fullbacks out of the backfield. Jameson moves the chains up to the 36-yard line, picks up 6 more. Marquise Spruill finally makes the stop.
Well, if you're Rutgers, you have plenty of time left, 3:21 and counting. You have 2 timeouts remaining, so you'd like to exhaust this Syracuse defense, keep them on the field, and take the football the length of the field now and really take the clock down to inside a minute and try to score and take the lead in this football game. Try to cash in for 7 and not settle for 3.
Completed ball to number 6, Sanu, and it's going to move the chains again for another first down. Cameron Lynch in coverage that time. They pick up 12. You know, you talk about the size of these receivers, and they are big and they're athletic. Is Dodd, not that I wouldn't either, the guy's averaging 12 catches a game, but is he locking in with number 6?
I would too. Yeah, I think so. Not so much today because he spread the football. The fullbacks caught 3 or 4, you know, touches between 2 players. But I would look in crunch time for number 6. You're going to depend on where he's at on the football field.
Dodd somehow got out of that pile. Doesn't pick up the first down. A penalty flag comes all the way over with the back judge. 9-yard pickup. And Syracuse, they're saying it's going to go against Rutgers.
Legal block in the back. Number 10 on the offense. 10-yard penalty. First down.
Well, number 10 on the offense, the big tight end, D.C. Jefferson.
Mike, the story today has been turnovers and penalties at the wrong time. There's the block in the back right there. No need for that because you know your quarterback's going to go down and slide anyway. So just lay off. If you see that number behind, D.C., lay off the block. And now you put yourself in a first and long situation.
Whistles will stop this. Rutgers will use another timeout. That's the second for Greg Schiano, leaving them with one with a minute 52 to go. So Doug Marrone, boy, he's holding that defense together with band-aids, but they're playing hard. Now, I like what Scott Schaefer said. They were number 7 in total defense last year. He says, you know, we can't chase stats. Just go out there and play hard. And there's no doubt that this defense plays hard.
Yeah, it's funny. Sometimes when you take a look at stats, you focus in so much on where you want to be, but you should go backwards. What's the end result? And then work yourself backwards.
Well, coming up on the Big East Network Halftime Report, we'll have Congemi's Corner as Antoine Bailey stopped by the corner this week to chat with John. Syracuse All Access, the ESPN cameras join Doug Marrone in the Orange all day on Monday. And, of course, we'll have the first half highlights and stats. It's all coming up in a minute 52 here at the Dome. Dodd looks, fires, and there's number 6 again. He put the ball in the carpet. No, he dropped it. It's going to be ruled an incomplete ball. Lynch in coverage again, so the linebacker on number 6 for most of the day. That's tough coverage.
Well, 1:47 left to go before halftime. Mark that down because Mohamed Sanu dropped the football, and you're not going to see that many times. He was trying to maybe do a little bit too much, but that was nice coverage by Cameron Lynch, that linebacker that stayed on his back. He's been targeted 8 times today, has Mohamed Sanu, and he's been very productive for Rutgers.
That's his first drop, but the second drop for Rutgers as a team. It's something Greg Schiano said we got to get away from. Here they come. Another blitz. It's complete. Jamison out of the backfield. Syracuse territory still on his feet inside the 45-yard line. Wow, he was bouncing off of people like a pinball. Syracuse player down. That's going to be Goggins, Deion Goggins, the senior from Los Angeles, who has really been productive for Scott Schaefer's defense this year.
You called it, Mike, a big hit, but the pressure was on. Anena tried to get to the quarterback, Chase Dodd. There's the big hit by number 1, Philip Thomas, but he bounces off of that, does Jamison, and looks like he had very close to the first down, maybe a yard short of the first down. The helmet pops off. He puts it right back on, but Deion Goggins, the worry now for Syracuse.
The Goggins coming out of the junior college ranks last year. And as did Bruce Irvin of West Virginia.
1:36 on the clock. 1:36. Thank you.
So Dodd felt the pressure and he got the ball off.
Well, sometimes you know you're going to take a shot and you have a free blitzer. You just have to maybe slide just subtly with your feet away from the pressure to give you enough time to deliver the football. Then the shake and bake about the 48-yard line. The big hit from Philip Thomas. But Juwan Jamison was able to move closer to the chains, and it looked like that pile just landed on Goggins, who was holding that left arm or right arm and right shoulder as he walked off the field.
And to finish that thought on Goggins, he came out of the junior college ranks in California, as did Bruce Irvin of West Virginia. He saw Irvin pick up 14 sacks last year for West Virginia, and Goggins didn't have a great year. So he's been really motivated, and he's come through, too. Goggins entered the game with 22 tackles from that nose guard position.
4 tackles for loss, and on the other side of the football, you have a quarterback on that play that was able to make a play when you had pressure in his face. So now it's a situation where you're coming down close to the end of the half. You have 1:36, a 3rd and 1. I give it to my back behind that big, young offensive line.
Rutgers, 3 of 8, converting 3rd downs. Martinick gets the call, and he's going to move the chains. He's down to the 40-yard line. He picks up three on the play. So Chase Dodd, the sophomore out of Lyman, South Carolina, hit on 66% of his passes, three touchdowns last week, and there's the number so far. Dodd, no penalty. Oh, there's the penalty flag. Sanu said they were hanging all over me. Sproul, the middle linebacker, was there, as was number 38, Cameron Lynch.
Mike, it might have been Cameron Lynch that had the arm of Mohamed Sanu.
Number 11 on the defense. Ball will be placed at spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
So it goes against number 11, that's Sproul. Let's get back to that chart with Chase Dodd, where he's gone with the football here so far this afternoon.
Well, Chase has been doing a nice job from the pocket. You can see from 15 yards and below, he likes the middle of the field to the right side. That's where Sanu has been most of the afternoon.
He goes right this time. Intended receiver was Sanu, and Philip Thomas thought he had it. And if he did, he might have had a pick six.
One of those leaders in the secondary for Syracuse. He's only a sophomore, and he's probably closer to 100% than any other defensive back. He made a play on the football that hung in the air for a long time. Boy, if you're Philip Thomas, you have to come down with that one.
They've got two guys on Sanu right now. Dodd, he was looking for him. He can't find him, so he throws this one away. Nice job by Syracuse bracketing number six, Mohamed Sanu.
You called it, Mike. That's where Chase Dodd wanted to go with the football. He wanted to go to number six, and that's his comfort zone right now. He's going to take a look down the middle of the field, but he wanted to go left after he didn't like it. But good job of bracketing inside out by Philip Thomas on the outside and Anena on the inside.
Brandon Sharp was putting on some heat, so Dodd had to get rid of the football.
This is where Sanu's been eating up the middle of the football field. He's in the bottom right.
Third down, they're going deep. And a diving stab at number 17. That's Brandon Coleman, the redshirt freshman. Very athletic player. His first career reception was a 44-yard touchdown.
Offensive coordinator Frank Cignetti takes a shot at the 6'6", 220 freshman. That ball just needed to hang in the air a yard to the outside because it was a good adjustment by Brandon Coleman. Just that Chase couldn't put either enough air under the football or get it where he wanted to. So now Greg Schiano, fourth and 10, is going to let that clock wind down. They have one timeout remaining. They will take it and then talk it over.
Ball resting at the 35-yard line.
Rutgers is taking their third and final timeout of the half.
And it comes with 54 seconds to go before we go to the break. All right, John Congemi, you go back to your college days. What do you do here? Fourth and 10.
Well, it's a situation where you have a field goal kicker that's one of three on the afternoon. He's missed from 50 yards and plus. So this would be close to, I would say, a 52, 53-yard
yep.
field goal. I would like to put it in the hands of my quarterback. I'd like to go for it because you have 54 seconds. You don't have any timeouts, but if you get the first down, you're going to get the clock to stop with the possession chains. I'd bring my offense back on the football field and try to get this fourth down opportunity.
Scarlet Knights averaging 36 points a game. They have three on the scoreboard here with 54 seconds to go.
You always have time to kick a field goal if you can convert on this fourth down chance. So I think this is a well-calculated, not a risk, but a good opportunity to take advantage of it by head coach Greg Schiano.
Sanu to the right, as is Cook Coleman. Arizona, the tight end, moving to the left side. That's Sanu. Two Syracuse players shadowing him. Dodd just hoping for maybe an offside here or something. There's the penalty flag. And it's going to go against Rutgers.
On the offense, 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
I don't know. I still would have rolled the dice and taken
my man number six, Mohamed Sanu, and use him as a decoy. You could tell by the formation, they had bracket coverage running all over the football field with him. You still had Joe Martinick in a situation where he could get out into the flat and make something happen with those big receivers in Coleman and Timothy Wright as well.
Dorner on at about the 45. Steve Rene standing back at his 10-yard line for Syracuse with 54 seconds to go. And this one hits at about the 5. It's going in the end zone. So Syracuse with 44 seconds on the clock will have it at the 20-yard line. 40-yard punt, net of 20. Turnovers, the name of the game, the name of the story so far here today.
There's been plenty of penalties and plenty of turnovers on the very first carry for Syracuse. Antoine Bailey coughed up the football. Jamal Merrill got on it. But the play of the game was the enormous hit in the Rutgers backfield by Deshaun Davis. The scoop and score on the outside by Rashard Anderson. That's the only touchdown that's been scored. Dodd tried to get that high snap out of the shotgun. Another fumble and turnover. The Orange. What do? The next play, they give it right back to Rutgers on the screenplay. Justin Francis, the defensive tackle, doing a great job of getting that interception.
So Syracuse keeps it on the ground with Bailey. The tackle just shy of the 25-yard line by Steve Bohannes, a gain of 4. So Bailey with 28 carries last week, 114 yards.
For Syracuse right now, you're going to not snap the football if you don't have to, and you're going to go in with a 4-point lead.
So Doug Marone trying to stay unbeaten at home. They'll go to 4-0 with a victory here today if they can hold on for the next 30 minutes. And you're right, that's going to be the final play of this first half. So Syracuse scores a defensive touchdown, a 65-yard return by Rashard Anderson. And Rutgers comes up with a field goal.
Well, if you're both teams, you have to stay away from penalties and turnovers in the second half. Whoever executes best is going to win this football game.
There's Cartman's kick and Jeremy Deering at the 7-yard line. Deering looking for a lane. He's up over the 35. A nice return of 27. Keon Lynn makes the stop. Let's look at the numbers with the quarterbacks now. Ryan Nassib and Chase Dowd in the first half.
Both guys completing 50%, but you can see the yards, only 63 yards for Ryan Nassib and that one interception. Dodd as well, 50%, 157. So he's faring a little bit better getting the yards. But right now, Syracuse and Ryan Nassib ahead by 4, 7-3.
And Dodd last week, 232, 3 touchdowns in the victory over against Ohio University. First possession, second half out of the I formation. Jamison dots the eye, gets the call, and he has nowhere to go. There's number 13. Looks like he's feeling pretty healthy to open up the second half.
Yeah, that right arm, right shoulder doing much better after halftime. Good tackle for a loss. That's his 5th tackle for a loss on the season. Deion Gogans does a nice job of getting in there. -3 on the carry. So now behind the chains right away is this Rutgers offense.
Mentioned the Syracuse defense has not allowed a 100-yard rusher this year. That's Sanu in motion. And they go the other way, and Pratt makes the catch up over the 40-yard line. He's drilled, but he holds on. Cameron Lynch makes the stop, a gain of 9. And it's going to bring up a third down.
You may see the adjustment in the second half, getting more people involved for Rutgers, because at the end of that quarter, it looked like Syracuse was bracket coveraging number 6, Mohamed Sanu.
Dodd fires, Sanu had it, and he dropped it. They're going to have to punt it away. Good coverage again. So number 28, Jeremy Wilkes, was all over number 6.
Good job by the Syracuse defense getting off the football field on third down. That's just a good break on the football by Wilkes, number 28, coming from that safety position. One of those guys that are stepping in for Shamarco Thomas, who's been out with an injury. So right away, Syracuse goes 3 and out and should get decent field position.
Justin Dorner at about the 30. He leads the Big East, averaging about 39.7. This is a good one. Renee backs up to the 10. He waved his arm. It's going to be a fair catch. At about the 7, they'll get the spot. So what are the keys to the second half, John?
Well, both teams struggled offensively in the first half. They're going to have to come up with a big play. I think a big play is going to change this football game. But for Syracuse offensively, they need to stay on the football field. Only 1 of 5 on third down. They only possess the football for just over 10 minutes. So Ryan Nassib and company have to make plays on third down to stay on the football field.
So Dorner gets off a 51-yard punt, and now Syracuse has a lot of green in front of them, so not good field position. Antoine Bailey in the backfield. Nassib under center. Nassib fires. Provo has his 5th catch all the way up to the 30, and there's some breathing room. 24-yard gain.
There's his security blanket going to his big tight end. For Rutgers defensively and on their sideline, they have to make a game-changing play to win in the second half. They really didn't do anything in that first half that was going to threaten you offensively, where you felt like Syracuse was on their heels, either in special teams or on defense coming up with a big pick for 6 or a turnover. They need to find something to change the momentum of this football game.
They came into the game with 13 forced turnovers. Ooh. Bailey's hit, and he's hit hard by Steve Boharnas, the middle linebacker. And Boharnas to second. 2nd and 5. Bailey gets tied up just over the line of scrimmage. That's Kasim Green. So Nassib with that 3.4 GPA. You know, he interns with an accounting firm in the summer. They said any correlation, any parallels with football and accounting? He said, well, as long as you keep your boss happy. But he's definitely smart out on that football field.
Well, his boss will be really happy on the sideline if they convert this third down.
Third and 4. Pressure. It's complete. They've got the first down. Jared West with his 2 big catches last week. That's his first grab.
And there's going to be a personal foul, Mike. There was a helmet on helmet to Ryan Nassib in the pocket. He took a shot.
Personal foul, roughing the passer. Illegal contact above the shoulders. 15-yard penalty, first down.
Credit Ryan Nassib for hanging in. He knew he was going to take a shot from defensive back David Rowe, who took not only a shot, but a helmet-on-helmet contact in the backfield. That's going to draw 15 every time. You have to be a tough customer to play quarterback at any level. John, but when you know you're going to take that shot coming from the secondary, it takes a lot of courage to stand in there and throw a strike.
Was it Rowe or was it Michael Lero, the defensive end, that came and lowered his head? I'll have to go back and take a look at it. Regardless, it's a first down, and it's a big, costly penalty against Rutgers. Bailey trying to get something going, finds a lane. 20. Bailey inside the 10-yard line. Logan Ryan finally makes the stop. Another penalty flag down. Before that run, he had 9 carries for 26. His longest run was 8 yards. This one goes 38.
Winning on first down is going to keep you out on that football field, and that's exactly what Antoine Bailey did. Huge run on first down.
Personal foul. 31 on the defense. Unnecessary roughness. Pass the distance to the goal. First down.
David Maluski just came in for Steve Boharnas at the middle linebacker spot.
That's what speed and vision does for you, Mike, on first down. It enables Antoine Bailey to get to the edge and then cut back inside the 10-yard line, tack on the penalty, and the Orange are inside the 5.
First and goal. Bailey, touchdown, Syracuse. So the senior from Landover, Maryland gets his 4th rushing touchdown. And in a game like this, that might be huge.
It is huge. Credit the quarterback toughness by Ryan Nassib hanging in there on third down. You tack on a completion with a penalty, then a big run on first down by Bailey. Now first and goal inside the 5, and Bailey's able to weave his way behind that big offensive line.
Ross Krautmann So Krautmann had been perfect in his 2 years as a college football player. This time it's blocked. So is it Logan Ryan getting in there? He's been all over the place.
Right side of your screen. It looked like Michael Hay on that right side just made himself small, ducking his shoulders and allowed some penetration off the edge as well. Big runs by Bailey. It's 13-3 Orange.
Krautmann with the kick. Taken at the 10-yard line. Up to the 25-yard line. That's Jordan Thomas, who grew up in Endicott about 45 minutes from here. He returns at 16 yards. And now the Scarlet Knights will have possession again. Steve Rene making the stop on the kickoff coverage team for Syracuse.
Now it's a little bit different game if your quarterback needs to make plays. He was 50% in the first half, was Chase Dodd, threw the football effectively, but now you're going to have to find a way to make plays in this second half. You know the Orange is going to turn up the heat and try to create pressure at the line of scrimmage and in that pocket. So for Chase Dodd, you have to be patient now.
Dodd going deep. Harrison, the intended receiver, and they're locked up. Kevin Scott, the fifth-year cornerback and one of the captains for the Syracuse team, was step for step with the big Mark Harrison.
Mike couldn't draw it up any better on the edge. Kevin Scott did an excellent job. When Harrison turned for the football, Scott turned for the football, didn't make any contact. That's just good defense on first down. One of those leaders in the secondary, tied for third in the Big East Conference with two interceptions, just solid on the edge.
So Dodd's 14 of 29 for 166 yards. He wants to put it up again. And this one almost picked off by Kevin Scott again. The intended receiver was Tim Wright. The ball floated on him a little bit, but Wright, he might have gave up at the last second.
First down, a little shy on throwing it out there for his receiver. This time Dodd throws it to the inside. He stepped up, had pressure in the pocket. So credit those guys rushing Chase Dodd. They were able to make him uncomfortable. Now on third down, Rutgers 4 of 11 in that situation.
Dodd won for his last seven through the air. Looking, and this one is picked off. Philip Thomas. I don't think Dodd saw him, John. Third turnover now.
Mike, the first thing we said was Dodd had to be patient in this series. Well, they went out and threw it on three consecutive plays, but the pressure by Goggins in the pocket led to this errant throw. Just high and inside, and good athleticism by Philip Thomas. That gives the Orange instant field position at the RU 31-yard line.
He started 5 of 6 there. His numbers 9 for 25 since. And here's Bailey with some running room inside the 20-yard line. David Rowe finally brings him down. So Big Mo has been awakened here at Syracuse, and he's definitely on the Orange sideline right now.
Another big run on first down. This offensive line doing a terrific job. Andre Civil, Desmond Wynn, Osei, Bujari, and Johnson doing a great job of moving the Rutgers front seven around.
Massive fires over the middle. Lemon caught it and dropped it. Had it inside the 10-yard line. Logan Ryan in coverage again.
It was a good job by Ryan closing the cushion on the outside. It made it a difficult catch for Alec Lemon. That just a quick slant, but made it a difficult catch because the pressure from behind. That's a good job of squeezing the receiver to the inside. This is tight end time. If you're the Orange, take a look for Nick Provo down here.
Bailey, left side, and he runs into the entire Rutgers defense, so at least 9 of the 11. Picks up 3. Michael Laro leading the parade there.
Now, Rutgers is a pressure-style defense, Mike, and last week in this situation, the Orange faced Toledo. They came out with an all-out blitz, and Ryan Nassib was able to throw a pretty pitcher, perfect pass to the back of the end zone to Alec Lemon. Let's see what Greg Schiano and this defense, if they dial pressure up on third and long.
Third and nine, they have to get down to about the 8 yard line. Nassib, not going to get there. Ebo Harness back on the field, and he tracked him down for the sack. That's the first sack for Rutgers here this afternoon, but they're 13th already this year.
Bo Harness looks like he's back to 100% on the field. Greg Schiano, the head coach for Rutgers, did bring some pressure, one more than Syracuse could protect. That's a situation where either the ball needs to be out, that clock needs to go a little bit faster, or you have to go ahead and tuck the football down and get what you can.
Ross Krautmann. This one is partially blocked, and it's going to be no good from 39. So Ross Krautmann, who kicked the field goal to beat Rutgers 13-10 last year to become bowl eligible, misses from 39 after it was partially blocked. John, I thought it was partially deflected, but it doesn't look like anybody got their hand on it, so Ross Krautmann might have that extra point in the back of his mind from last week, because if they didn't block it, he certainly pulled this one.
Well, Greg Schiano will take it, because that's twice now Syracuse has started inside of Rutgers territory, and they've come away with a missed 39-yard field goal and an interception.
That's Gary Nova at quarterback, and the handoff goes to Jamison, and he has nowhere to go. Gary Nova's a true freshman out of Don Bosco Prep. And Greg Schiano said that he wants to get him in every game just for the experience.
Rutgers goes three plays and out, and Chase Dodd throws that interception. It's a situation where now you have a young kid on the road down by 10 points. And I know head coach Greg Schiano has a lot of confidence in Gary Nova, so he's not afraid of this situation to put in a young quarterback, because I think offensive coordinator Frank Cignetti will be able to manage the game for him.
He's got Pratt in the slot. He's looking deep, though. The true freshman looking, and oh, he almost had Coleman. But again, number 26, Kevin Scott, making a great defensive play. Or did Coleman just drop it?
And that's a play you got to make. If you're Brandon Coleman and you're 6'6", 220 pounds, you need to go up and get the football. And this is a pretty darn good throw by a freshman quarterback who takes a shot. Go up and get the football. That hits you right in stride. I know you may have had some problems with Scott, 26, coming over and getting a hand in the way of catching the football. But if you're a young quarterback out there and you throw one on the money down the field, you got to come away with that catch.
I stand corrected. I thought Scott deflected it. Big third down play now for Nova. Dumps it underneath. And Jamison doesn't have anywhere to go. He's shy of the 20-yard line. Had to get up to the 32 for the first down. And Jeremy Wilkes makes the stop.
Caleb Johnson just took a little shoulder into a Syracuse player, and that's going to back them up 15 more yards for a personal foul.
Dead ball. Personal foul. 72 offense. Unnecessary roughness. Half the distance to the goal. Fourth down.
True freshman from Jacksonville, Florida.
Third personal foul penalty on Rutgers and Greg Schiano. It's really a senseless penalty because the play was over. You're going to see 72 possibly come into the screen right there and deliver a blow that didn't have to happen. Now you lose field position for your special teams.
Well, Dorner had a 51-yard punt the last time out. They could use a boomer right now. Renee standing at the midfield stripe. Dorner from his own end zone. A lot of heat. And this one hits at the 49 and bounces out of bounds. 39-yard punt. There is a flag back in the end zone.
Personal foul. Roughing the kicker. 15-yard penalty. First down.
Well, I guess that's better than a 51-yard punt, John.
Yeah, we talked about playing smarter in the second half. We talked about all the penalties in the first half for Syracuse and Rutgers. Three personal fouls against Rutgers, and now you come out of the locker room, you have six penalties already. You have Rutgers backed up in their own end. I don't know if that was roughing. It looked like he went well underneath the kicker. It was definitely maybe a running into, but I'm not sure if it was the 15-yard variety.
Well, I'll bet you Jeremy Wilkes agrees with everything you're saying right now. 7.5 minutes to go, third quarter. All defense, 13-3 right now. Nova stays in the game at quarterback, the true freshman. Second series for the freshman goes under center this time. Steps up, finds his man. That's 81 Mark Harrison for the completed pass. Picks up 8.
Great call on first down by offensive coordinator Frank Cignetti, making it very easy for the young quarterback Gary Nova. You put little play action, Martinick's in the flat, you have the triangle. Martinick in the flat, Sanu a little bit higher on the curl route, and then you have Mark Harrison coming down underneath. So it's a good situation to go through your progression for a young quarterback and make a very simple read.
That's our referee, Tom Tomczak. He called the official timeout just moments ago. And he's on the phone calling upstairs. Not sure if it's a
maybe a clock
situation.
Yeah, it's the only thing you could think of, that they may have set the clock or not started it properly.
It's definitely a clock issue, I'm told, by John Kettering, our producer. And we'll wait the call by Mr. Tomczak. Well, 7:23 was on the clock before the phone call, and 7:23 remains on the clock. There's Chase Dodd, who replaced Tom Savage, a one-time freshman All-American at quarterback, and now Dodd stands on the sidelines. And we figured Nova would get some playing time, but we didn't know how much. Jamison couldn't find the handle on the pitch, and he runs into a wall of Syracuse players. A loss of 3.
Boy, 2 steps forward on first down and then 3 steps back on second down. That's a situation where you'd like to go downhill and get that first down. You fake the toss, and you can't handle it from the running back position on the toss from quarterback Nova to Jamison, and then a swarm of blue jerseys led by Davis, who made that big hit in the first half.
I think Davis likes to hit. Even that time he stuck his face mask to the numbers.
He liked to hit.
Jamison 13 for just 19 yards, 13 carries for 19 yards after getting 97 yards last week. And there's going to be a timeout. It's going to be charged to Rutgers.
Rutgers has called their first timeout.
They've got Pratt, and it's good for the first down. So Gary Nova, the freshman, moves the chains, a pickup of 13. This Rutgers football team came in the game converting 48%. They were 4 of 12 before that 3.
This is a big-time play. You get motion, you get a hook outside by Martinick, and then you get a runoff down the field and an out route. Just a good job of finding the crease in the seam. This is nice. You get a spread. You get that diamond look, a high-low on the edge. Good job by Gary Nova finding the open receiver.
Nova going deep again, and again looking for Coleman. And this time it's broken up by Anderson.
And Mike, Brandon Coleman, we talked about his size at 6'6". If you get a jump ball opportunity, the one thing, if it's a touch underthrown, you have to stop and go up and get the football. That's a situation where you quit running and you go play the football and use your size, not drift down the football field towards the end zone. Because if you're 6'6", you have to be able to climb the ladder and make that play.
John, I said Anderson got the start. He did not make that play. That's Keon Lynn, who battled that sore shoulder from last week's Toledo game. So credit Lynn for the breakup there. So Nova 3 of 5 in the game, another timeout call.
Rutgers has called their second timeout.
Still have 5:42 to go in the third. I guess they want to make sure that they get something here on this possession.
Well, they don't want to put that young quarterback in a situation where defensive coordinator Scott Schaefer dials up a pressure he hasn't seen.
Nova looking for that big redshirt freshman, Coleman, 6'6", 220-pounder. Coleman still looking for his first catch.
See how the receiver and the DB keep drifting downfield. I know it's tough when you're running full speed, but as a receiver, and he'll get this. Brandon Coleman will get this with experience. But when he's going down there and the ball's underthrown, use your 6'6 advantage. This is the advantage that Rutgers receivers have against Syracuse right now. You have 6'2 Mohamed Sanu, but down at the bottom, Brandon Coleman, 6'6, 220 pounds. You have to go up and make yourself play that big, which means stop your feet, go up and play the football in the air.
Second and 10 from the 43-yard line.
Nova at quarterback. Jamison dots the eye. This one's complete. Sanu gets the ball, but he has nowhere to go because Philip Thomas is all over him.
Great anticipation, Mike, by Philip Thomas. He's the leader in that secondary. He looked like he was shot out of a cannon. He read this the entire way. Watch the blue jersey come in the backfield. He almost gets the pick. Had it not been for Sanu, or for on the outside number five, Timothy Wright, getting a piece of Thomas, Thomas might have went the distance anticipating that throw.
I think I saw a big grin on his face, too, after he made that defensive
You might
play.
As well smile when you know it's coming your way. And now the matchup, the good thing Scott Schaefer has done, the defensive coordinator, number eight, Keon Lynn, is 6'1". He's going up against those big, tall wide receivers.
This time it's third and 10. Whistle's blowing, and the play has stopped.
Maybe a delay.
Offense, 5-yard penalty. Third down.
So third and 15. Unless, of course, you wanted to decline it here, John. I mean,
I'm sure Doug Marrone's pleading his case on the sidelines, but he's going to take that five. He doesn't have a choice. Now you have third and very long, third and 15 for a young quarterback. So on the Rutgers sideline, you want to dial up something safe, but you've been kind of rolling the dice, going deep a couple times to Brandon Coleman.
Eight penalties now for Rutgers for 59 yards. Nova is going down on a third and 15. The ball is loose. It's still loose. And Syracuse says, hey, we got it inside the 15-yard line. Marinovic made the hit in the backfield, and yes, it's Syracuse football. Four turnovers now. Marinovic broke through from the left side.
Marinovic comes in front side and gets the quarterback to escape the pocket.
No.
It looked like if the ball hit his foot, the arm was going forward, but he may have been in the grasp of Marinovic. Great pressure to get around the young tackle, Khalib Johnson, by Marinovic. Boy, that's a tough call for the official because they ruled it a fumble on the field. But definitely Gary Nova's arm was in a throwing motion. They did not blow the play dead there, Mike.
Was he outside the tackle box? If anything, it should be intentional grounding then, huh? If it is ruled?
If it is ruled, but right now it's a fumble on the field that was carried inside the 20, close to the 16-yard line, when it was finally picked up by Marquise Sproul.
Well, I think they're going to go upstairs and check with Jack Kramer.
It may end up being an incomplete pass or a grounding call.
The previous play was a fumble. The play is under further review.
Mikey, definitely, Gary Nova definitely made a throwing motion, but the ball hit his foot. It looked like it was a fumble to the official. He escapes the pocket. Now, talking about the tackle box, he's well outside the tackle box. He makes the motion of throwing the football forward. You definitely see the arm go forward.
Well, if he's outside the tackle box, he's safe then, right?
That's right.
So it might be ruled an incomplete pass.
Marinovic taking him to the ground, but watch the arm of the young quarterback. He cocks the football back, and it definitely goes forward before he hits the ground. He's outside of the tackle box. but it was ruled a fumble on the field.
And again, Jack Kramer would need indisputable video evidence, and his arm obviously was going forward. There's no doubt about that.
Tough situation for a young quarterback to come in. You go third and 15. And remember, you don't put yourself in this situation if you make the plays down the field that he was dead on the money to the wide receiver on the outside. It looked like Coleman earlier in this set of downs.
Well, the Syracuse defense, they lost two corners, two linebackers, three defensive linemen. They're all dinged up, but boy, they are playing their hearts out.
And remember, Syracuse has started inside of the Rutgers territory twice today, both times ending up missing a field goal and turning into an interception. But on this last play, third and 15, Marinovich comes in, has the quarterback, Gary Nova, in his grasp. It was ruled a fumble on the field, but you definitely see the quarterback, Nova, in a throwing motion.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands.
So it stands as a fumble. If there's no indisputable video evidence to reverse the call, it stands, and that's what they call, so it's going to be Syracuse ball.
I'm not so sure I agree with that after seeing the replay a couple times, because there was a throwing motion. He just didn't let go of the football.
So it's Syracuse ball with the lead. Bailey in the backfield. Can they cash in? This one, David Stevens was the intended receiver, looking for his first catch. The backup tight end has a catch in every game this year, but that'll bring up a second down.
Huge part of the game here now for Rutgers defensively. They've been successful every time they've been in this situation. Ball on their own end. Syracuse has great field position. They've been able to keep the orange off the scoreboard. Can they do it for a third time?
Bailey bounces off. Boy, nice job of slipping that tackle. Breaks to the outside and gets down inside the 10, 6-yard gain. Logan Ryan finally pushed him out of bounds.
And Mike, I don't care what they list Antoine Bailey at, 5'6", 5'7". You have to tackle him to the ground, because Steve Beauharnais had him dead to rights in the backfield. And again, number 29, Antoine Bailey, breaks the tackle at the line of scrimmage and makes a positive play.
Third and four. Nassar fires past his man Lemon inside the 5-yard line. That's going to be a first down, so it's first and goal.
Good job by the quarterback, Ryan Nassar, being accurate in the red zone. Anytime you get down inside your 20-yard line, everything happens a little bit faster. So you have to be on time with the football and accurate. Last time, Mike, they were inside the 5. They spread the football field out, and they let Antoine Bailey start left and then go back to the right side. This time they go empty.
Bailey split outs.
Quarterback draw, possibly.
To the top of your screen. They go the other way, and this one's going to be picked off. It's Rowe. One man to beat. And he goes down at about the 28-yard line. He tried to go against the grain to get away from Ryan Nassar, but he returns at 27 yards. And Zach Chabane, a big offensive guard, finally brought him down. Third turnover for Syracuse.
Credit this Rutgers defense. Every time they've been in a situation where they're backed up in their own end, they've come up with a big play. That time the ball should have been caught, but it wasn't. David Rowe gets the deflection, and the big tackle on the play was Zach Chabane. He came back from the left guard position after Nassar was able to force Rowe back to the middle. But again, Rutgers keeps the orange off the scoreboard. Just a huge play in this football game.
7 turnovers in the ball game. Scarlet Knights down by 10, but they're still breathing. If they pull this out, Doug Marrone won't be happy with the missed opportunities. There's a penalty flag.
Another drop. Delay, Mike.
Delay. Offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Well, Gary Nova came in just hitting 35% of his passes. But he said, hey, how many backup quarterbacks get in every game? And he really appreciated that. I don't know if he knew he'd be playing this many series in the second half for Greg Schiano.
Yeah, I'm not sure. 9 penalties and 64 yards and you get a turnover. It's kind of, it's one of those that you can't have an excuse for. You get off the field, you get a play called, you shouldn't have a delay of game coming off of a turnover.
So the two freshmen now facing a first and 15. Jamison running hard up over the 25-yard line. Back over the line of scrimmage, or close to it, but not too much running room. Dyshawn Davis making the stop again.
Big momentum shift, Mike, in this football game. It looked like the Orange were going to go in a couple times in this football game to make it more than a 10-point lead, but this Rutgers defense has been able to keep their football team in the game, and now the young quarterback has an opportunity at second and long to make a play.
Now Jamison is split out wide. That's Harrison in motion. Nova turns, fires, it's picked off! Oh! Philip Thomas had his third INT and he dropped it, and this one was going to be a pick six.
I believe they opened the doors of the Carrier Dome for Philip Thomas. He was going to go right down and have something to eat. Look at this. All he sees is the end zone, and he drops the football. The sophomore was 35 yards away from making this a 20-3 football game. And now the crowd back in it, but a huge opportunity wasted by this defense.
Win or lose, Thomas is going to relive that play about six times. Third and 11 now for Nova, and lots of pressure. He gets rid of it, and Pratt has it for the first down. Wow, that was a wing and a prayer. Nice job of finding number 7 open on the far sideline.
We have to give this young quarterback credit. That just looked like a bit of a duck and chuck, but he knew where his players were on the football field. That takes incredible strength and courage to throw this football just out of a mass of people to be that accurate. Doesn't matter what it looks like, because on the receiving end was Pratt for a first down.
They pick up 18. Oh! Again, it's Davis and Jamison. Well, they're going to have to trade email addresses or something. I mean, they've really gotten to know each other pretty well.
I'm not sure if Jamison wants to. He's been hitting that backfield a couple of times by Davis again. Just a huge hit in the backfield, 3 yards deep, but credit Jamison, keep those legs going, showing his toughness, turning it in to a 1 yard gain.
He's only a redshirt freshman, but he might go back to the huddle and say, who's supposed to be blocking 35?
Somebody get 35 in blue.
Nova 5 of 8 with 41 yards. Sproul almost had him. Instead, he completes it to Harrison. Harrison's knee touched at about the midfield stripe. Picks up 4 on the play. Attention golfers and club pros, online registration now open for the 2012 ESPN National Golf Challenge. Log on to ESPNGolf.com to sign up and find a participating course near you. Boy, Nova's had his share of third down situations here. Here's another one. Plenty of time this time, and it's dropped. Martinick. It was a tough catch. He was moving forward, but Martinick rarely drops a ball.
Yeah, that ball was just a little bit low and outside by Gary Nova, because that's a sure-handed receiver, and Joe Martinick just had to stretch a little bit too far on that third down opportunity. So Syracuse finds a way for their defense to get off the football field. Just a lot of swing of emotion in this football game, and right now Syracuse trying to make something happen with their special teams.
Dorner, high but short. It's a Rutgers bounce, and it's going to be down near the 10-yard line. But John, Rutgers with 4 drop passes, and now the 45-yard punt gives Syracuse the ball, but a lot of real estate in front of them. Now for our AT&T All-America Player of the Week updates. How about Ray Graham? Numbers Thursday night against USF. 226 on the ground, a couple of touchdowns, and over 300 yards of total offense.
He was a beast. He was definitely a difference maker, and it really wore out that South Florida defense. It looked like the pace and tempo of that offense, and Ray Graham, 2 touchdowns, 226. He had a heck of a night.
And don't forget to text vote to 55862 from your mobile phone to vote for a chance at a trip to the national championship. That's going to be the final play of quarter number three. So we have
three opportunities inside the 30-yard line.
Nassib wants to throw deep in his own territory. Dorian Graham, the one-time defensive back, up over the 15-yard line, picks up 17. Or check it, make it just 7. Look at his numbers in the fourth quarter, huh? Nassib, talk about cool in the clutch.
Well, I bet Doug Marrone and offensive coordinator Nathaniel Hackett couldn't wait to get to the fourth quarter because you know it's going to get better. He's played a solid game so far, but a situation where he gets better with time, and right now this is his time to shine.
Well, those really were impressive numbers, though.
Absolutely.
Huh? Nassim's going to hold on to this one. Good coverage downfield by Rutgers. Steve Boharnish makes the sack. It's going to be the second for Rutgers. It's going to be his ninth career sack, and now it's 4th and 7, so Syracuse has to give up the football again.
Credit, much, a lot of credit is due to this Rutgers defense because they've kept this team in the football game. Boharnish has gone out with injury. Guys have been running around. Kasim Green coming up with plays. Logan Ryan on the outside. Everybody's contributed.
Ralpers with his 5th punt. Sanu at the midfield stripe. And he's going down in his own territory. Dorian Graham. Good coverage. Number 10. A 33-yard punt. No return. But Rutgers has good field position.
Now I'm interested to see what quarterback Rutgers comes out with. If they come out with the young freshman and Gary Nova, or they let Chase Dodd come back in. It looks like Nova, the young freshman, is going to get the fourth quarter. So it's his game right now to get this offense ignited and get them back into the game. Only a 10-point game, but you have the feeling that they're a penalty or a turnover away from making this, you know, much more of a lead for the Orange.
Freshman fires, looking for Sanu. It's incomplete. Ball went to the outside. Sanu turned inside.
One of those back shoulder throws, Mike, that it's a timing route, and you may have more repetition with Chase Dodd than you do with Gary Nova. Gary tried to get that ball to the back shoulder where only Sanu could catch it, but a little high and outside, and I think Sanu wasn't ready when Gary was ready to deliver the football.
Sanu, 5 catches for 55 here after 16 grabs last week. Nova, there's pressure. He's going down, and again, it's number 35, Dyshawn Davis. Only a freshman, but he says, hey, I want to be the Big East Defensive Player of the Week. This guy has been a beast here today.
We talk about legendary players at Syracuse. It looks like Dyshawn Davis is working his way up the ladder. Just a great job again. Another tackle for loss and almost a turnover. The running back, Jamison, cannot handle the force and the authority of that pass rush from Dyshawn Davis. So third down conversion, 6 of 16 for Rutgers now. Third and a long 19.
Nova goes deep, and he's looking for Tim Wright. Penalty flags all over the place. Tim Wright got tangled up with Rashard Anderson.
Pass interference, 9 defense, 15-yard penalty, first down.
So when it's 3rd and 19, boy, that's a break.
Rashard Anderson was definitely fooled on the edge. He almost came up with the horse collar tackle, but at an opportune time, 3rd and 19, you just play deep of the deepest. You don't have to worry about biting on that first move. There's the horse collar, the right arm gets a hold of the receiver, Timothy Wright, but no need to bite on 3rd and 19. Keep everything in front of you and come up and make the tackle.
But once he bit, he thought he was going to get burned for the touchdown there, so he made sure. Jamison looks for a hole on the left side. Gets back to the line of scrimmage, maybe a yard on the play, but Corey Boatman makes the stop.
Jamison trying to use that speed on the outside, but Doug Marrone in this defense of Scott Schaefer, the defensive coordinator, they did a nice job of setting the edge. They forced everything back into all those blue jerseys in the middle of the football field. So a good play of using the contain of that sideline and the edge by this defense.
Nova goes deep again. Some bumping and shoving, and Harrison comes down with the football inside the 10-yard line. Kevin Scott in coverage for Syracuse, and there's Harrison, the big 6'3", 230-pounder.
Mike, they finally climb the ladder and connect on a deep ball. Mark Harrison, 6'3", goes up and over. A little push on the shoulder pads of Kevin Scott. It may have thrown him off to make that vertical leap. No call, though, but Mark Harrison goes up. Another one of those big play, big size receivers go up and make a play for Rutgers.
Big 38-yard gain, too. Well, Nova wanted to go to the bag of tricks now. There's a intentional grounding. This freshman says, hey, I was outside the tackle box and I saw two receivers down there.
Intentional grounding. 15 on the offense. Lost it down at the spot of the foul.
What?
Second down.
Yeah, he was outside the tackle box, but watch this. Tom yeah. Tomczyk says,
I don't believe the ball came across even close. Well, it was closer than we thought, but it was out definitely about a couple yards shy of where the ball was snapped. So second down, a good effort again of trying to get out of the grasp of Marinovich, but that's his second sack of the afternoon.
Might have been decent form for a shot put. Trying to set something up over the middle. Pratt has the football, but again, heavy, heavy pressure coming by number 91, Brandon Sharp. They pick up three. And again, the young quarterbacks will be facing a third and long.
If your offensive coordinator, Frank Cignetti, you have to line up in a formation where you're able to get Sanu either man-to-man, or if you draw a double team, get it to somebody else. Who's your next option? Is it Mark Harrison on the outside one-on-one, or is it somebody else? But you have to get a formation where you have one-on-one with your best player.
Sanu's at the top of your screen. Nova, season opening, fires, incomplete. Paul Carrizzolo, who caught his first touchdown pass of his career last week, was the intended receiver. Nova just overshot him. So San Santee, he missed a 45-yard field goal last year late in the fourth quarter. Syracuse wound up winning that game 13-10. He's missed two here today. He's missed from 51 and 47. He's been good from 27. This is a 33-yarder. And he drills it from 33. So San Santee with his 52nd career field goal. Rutgers has three more, but still down by a touchdown.
With turnovers, they've been able to make plays defensively to keep themselves at only a one-score game.
Justin Dorner. With the kick, it's a low line drive, and it's taken by Cabina at about the 1 yard line. And the true freshman cuts back, still on his feet, and he's dropped at the 30. 26 yard return by the true freshman. Next Saturday on the Big East Network Game of the Week, Lyle McCombs and the UConn Huskies head into Morgantown to take on Geno Smith and the Mountaineers of West Virginia. The action starts at noon Eastern. Check your local listings. Looks like Johnny McEntee might be settling in as the starting quarterback for the Huskies.
It sounds that way, and one guy that has definitely settled in is Geno Smith. He's third nationally in yards per game, fourth in total offense. He leads the Big East in both categories. He's put on a pretty good performance so far this season.
So at the 30, decent field position. Obviously, you want to eat clock now with 10 and a half minutes to go. What's going through Ryan Nassim's mind?
You want to eat clock, but you can't be conservative either. You need a score out of this drive. You need to go ahead and take about 4 or 5 minutes off the clock if you can. win the battle on third down, stay on the football field, and keep the pressure on this Rutgers defense.
Bailey picked up one on the last play, so it's second and nine. Nassib turns, fires. Wow, the intended receiver was Alec Lemon. But again, 12. Nassib was feeling pressure.
I'm sorry, Mike, and credit Scott Ballone. That was a situation where they cut him dead loose down the middle of the football field, and Nassib had to throw this ball well before he was ready. So credit Ballone. He's that stud up front for Greg Schiano, their head coach of Rutgers. He's the guy they like to cause havoc in the pocket.
And just like that, it's third and nine. Nassib, 10 of 20 for 105 yards and two INTs. Graham, he's got it, and he's still on his feet. Oh, wow. How about Daron Harmon grabbed his foot? He saved a touchdown.
Harmon did an excellent job of holding on to whatever he could, but a great job by number 10, Dorian Graham, of going and concentrating on the football and then holding on to it. Watch the tackle, the shoestring tackle by Harmon, but that's just a good touch throw by Ryan Nassib out to open space and a big play for this Orange offense.
30 yards, Graham with two catches for 38. Bailey cuts back inside the 35. Boharnes makes the tackle, but big 30-yard gain kind of changes the whole complexion of what you're calling at this juncture. Huh?
A little bit more momentum now on the Orange sideline. You feel it in the way they're getting in and out of the huddle. You feel it in the play call, and you win on first down. Ryan Nassib, we showed you his numbers in the fourth quarter. He's been nearly perfect closing out football games. Now with 8:57 left to go and counting, he needs to continue that string.
Jerome Smith, the sophomore from Delaware. The running back comes on the field, and he gets the call. Smith bounces to the outside, and he's sniffing out that first down marker. He's close. Khalil Glad finally makes the stop. Now Smith on the field. Prince Tyson Gully last week averaged 6.6 yards a carry, hurt his shoulder. He's gone for the season, so he's not coming back.
Yeah, between Jerome Smith and Antoine Bailey right now, looks like that's going to be the 1-2 punch to lead Rutgers, or to lead Syracuse in this fourth quarter. Now you have a third and short. Last time they tried to throw the football in this situation, they have a big back behind quarterback Ryan Nassib.
Smith goes 215 pounds. He's got the first down. Picks up four. I don't want to date myself, but the way he bounced off, he looked like Don Nottingham, the old Baltimore Colt, the human bowling ball.
That's right. You know what, if you have a big back like that, 5'11", 213, if he can square his shoulders up, you give him a little bit of a crease, he's going to get that first down on third and short. He runs into his own guys because he's so young. He had that head down. He said, I'm going to go for a yard at least. Good job of bouncing off for the first down.
Nassib. A little miscommunication. There was a pump fake there, but he thought Stevens thought he was going to go deep, and Nassib didn't think that way. How about Bailey, though, huh? I mean, last week, 114 yards. Doug Marone's offense had 88 total yards at halftime, and right now Bailey with 92 rushing yards, so he's flirting with another 100-yard game.
And he has that one touchdown.
Second down. Well, there's number 11 again, Logan Ryan. The fans here thought he was over his back, but no penalty flag dropped.
Close contact by Logan Ryan on number 10, Graham. Boy, it looked like that right arm was all over number 10's back. You couldn't barely make out the number because of Logan Ryan having that right arm on the back of Dorian Graham, but no call from the officials. Now you have third down and that clock winding down. At 12 seconds on the play clock, they may end up having to take a timeout here.
Syracuse is charged with the first timeout.
So with no penalty flag there, that goes down as a drop pass. So we've seen seven drop passes in this game. Four by Rutgers and three now by Syracuse. But Nassib facing a third and 10. Tries to slip out, nowhere to go. There's another sack by Rutgers. Justin Francis now with 14 and a half career sacks. The third one on the afternoon for the Scarlet Knights.
And Scott Malone was there as well, Mike. So a lot of pressure in the pocket. This offensive line needs to do a better job on third and long. You know you're going to feel heat, but you have to protect the football. And I think Ryan Nassib didn't want to force it. He protected the football and tried to get it back to the line of scrimmage.
Ross Krautmann kicked the game winner last year to win it 13 to 10. This one from 43. It's blocked again. Oh, my. Here go the Scarlet Knights. This is a different ball game after the block kick. Marcus Cooper turns, sees the flag on the field. John Anselmo, the special teams coach, was worried about punt block, but that's in the kicking game right now.
42 on the return team. It's a live ball foul for unnecessary roughness. 15-yard penalty. First down, Rutgers ball.
Wow, Steve Boharnas.
A big-time play by special teams again by Rutgers. Looked like Jamal Merrill, he may have got a piece of an earlier one. He gets this block, and then running down the sideline is Marcus Cooper, but a bad play by Steve Boharnas, probably well behind
Wow.
the would-be touchdown. A 60-yard return, but it's going to come back because of a personal foul well behind the play of the touchdown.
That could have been the equalizer.
That's the third time, Mike, that the special teams for Rutgers has been able to make a play on either an extra point attempt or a field goal attempt.
So Morrell gets the block, but they don't get the touchdown. Nova, the true freshman, back on the field to quarterback this team. Jamison inside the 45-yard line. It's a live ball personal foul charged to Steve Boharnas, the middle linebacker.
And it probably, Mike, had no factor in the at the end result of that football play being a touchdown for Rutgers. So they take points off the scoreboard. They have great field position, but they lose that momentum of scoring on special teams.
Nova goes underneath to Jamison. He's going to pick up the first down inside the 35-yard line. Plenty of time to go. 5:44. It picks up 11. Now watch the lower right corner of your screen. Number 42 right there.
Actually, it was a trip. It looked like almost a trip. Maybe he was blocked into that, Mike. It's a situation where it's at least 20 yards behind the play.
Ouch. Nova puts it up, intended for Sanu. Hey, John, you know, we talk about that Wildcat or Wild Knight. They've kind of gotten away from that. But Sanu has thrown four touchdowns in his career. But let's go back and take a look at Boharnas one more time. Right there, number 42 at the bottom of your screen, right in the corner. Like they
collided, and it looked like his feet taken from underneath him, and it tangled with the lineman for Syracuse going downfield and Michael Hay.
Second and 10. Whistles will blow this one dead. The timeout was called by Syracuse.
Syracuse has called their second timeout.
So they have one remaining with 5:11. What else? Nice job by Martinik to pick up that blitz, and he overshoots his man. Again, looking for number six, Sanu. Keon Lin in coverage.
Well, Mike, we talked about the size factor on the outside for Rutgers and their wide receivers going up against the defensive backs that have been hurt and injured and maybe not as tall on the outside. They've definitely given the young freshman quarterback, Gary Nova, the green light to throw that fade route up there because he's thrown it probably five or six times, connecting one time. Nova's 9 of 17 for 94 yards, one interception. He's been sacked three times. Let's see if defensive coordinator Scott Schaefer dials up the pressure or plays heavy zone on third and 10.
Nova fires, has his man. Good coverage right over the middle. They only pick up two on the play. Phillip Thomas making that defensive play. Now Greg Schiano looking up, 4:50. Clock is running, down by a touchdown.
I think this is a good call. You have to go for it here because your defense has been so good. You're going to get another opportunity, at least you hope so, if your offense doesn't convert on fourth down. But if I'm offensive coordinator Frank Cignetti, I haven't seen Mohamed Sanu in a long time. Might want to see him on fourth down.
Nova goes up top looking for Pratt. And Pratt having a big day. He came in with just three catches. Picks up 12 and the first down.
Big time play by a young receiver and a young quarterback. Sophomore receiver Pratt on the down and out, but a lot of courage shown by a young quarterback. He knew he was going to take a shot and had the arm strength to get it outside. Pratt on the afternoon, six receptions for 55 yards.
Definitely his biggest day so far this year. Still 4 minutes on the clock. They're at the red zone now at the 20. Inside the 15-yard line as Jamison keeps those legs going.
Jeremy Wilkes on the tackle.
Wilkes makes the stop, but now 3:44. Syracuse, they've been in overtime twice against Wake Forest, last week against Toledo.
If you're Rutgers, you're not in a big hurry right now. You want that clock to keep churning down and try to put pressure with time and energy right now on offense.
Jamison inside the 10-yard line, and now it's going to be first and goal for Rutgers. Marquise Spruill makes a stop, but not before he picks up five more. So they've been leaning on this defense for the entire afternoon. Now they have to really lean heavily on these guys.
And this is a team offensively for Rutgers that struggled in the red zone. They're seventh in the Big East Conference. See if they can turn the tide on that right now.
Jamison inside the 5-yard line, a second and goal. Touchdown and the extra point ties it at 13. Touchdown and two wins it. You're on the road. You tie it and play for overtime, you go for the win, John.
I think you tie it right now because your defense is playing so well. You may get the ball back. You have one timeout. First, you have to score. And that's what Greg Schiano is worried about right now. He's taking a look at that clock and thinking about those options.
Rutgers trying to snap a six-game road skid. Sanola fires. I knew it before this game was over. He's thrown four touchdown passes. He's carried once, and now he's thrown the ball once.
You called it, and credit the Syracuse defense for not biting on the end around. The timing was a little botched offensively, but Sanu does have a great right arm, and you called it, Mike, earlier in this game. They have thrown it, and he's thrown it with success. So now a third and goal at the 3-yard line. 6 of 18 on third down, the Rutgers offense. So it's a situation where they have probably two downs to get it in.
Nova fires, touchdown, Sanu. Mohamed Sanu with his fifth touchdown reception. Now it's up to San Santee to tie this game up.
Great patience by the young quarterback to allow his big play receiver. It was a blitz from the strong side, the right side, and Sanu, all he had to do was walk away from Deion Goggins, who had coverage.
Santee, no doubt about that one, right down the middle. Now you go back and you think about that missed extra point by Ross Krautmann. Nice 11-play drive by a true freshman quarterback.
46 yards, took 4:25 off the clock. Now you leap back because of a personal foul.
Krautmann's missed from 39 and had one blocked from 43. Now Nassib with 2:04 to go. Lennon up near the 30, had to get to the 32 to move the chains and stop the clock. They pick up 8.
Nice gain on first down to come out of the last series of this game.
Bailey weaves his way through traffic. That'll stop the clock while they move the chains. On the first down, and Justin Francis makes the stop. Bailey picks up 7. As we take a look at the game recap, Rutgers 4 turnovers, Syracuse 3. Just those 2 interceptions by Nassib, very uncharacteristic. He came in with just 1 pick with 9 touchdowns. Ballone makes the stop.
Timeout for Syracuse.
Syracuse has called their final timeout. 30-second timeout. Would the clock operator please put 1:30 on the clock?
So
1:30.
Put 2 seconds on, so there's 90 seconds to go.
Thank
Ross
you.
Krautmann, a freshman All-American last year, was 18 of 19. There he is. That's their field goal kicker. He's only a sophomore. He was 23 of 25 coming into the game, but as we mentioned, he missed from 39, had one blocked from 43.
If I'm Syracuse and Ross Krautmann, I'm not worried about him making the kick or the hold. I'm worried about those 9 other guys in front of him trying to protect, because Rutgers has been able to get through from the right side of the offense, the defensive left, and been able to get a piece of a couple kicks today and make a big change in the complexion of the outcome of this game.
Second down, 90 seconds on the clock. Nassib takes off. Well, he looked at that sideline. He said it's too far away. Picks up 2. Again, Logan Ryan on the stop defensively.
Here comes pressure.
Third and 5 for Nassib. They got it. Van Chu inside Rutgers territory. First down. Pick up 9. Clock stops with 61 seconds to go.
Again, experience and comfort in this offense. He knew exactly when Van Chu was coming out of that route. Good throw behind on third down.
Come back to Van Chu. The defense by Logan Ryan. Van Chu, who came in with 18 catches. That was his first catch in the play preceding that one.
Logan Ryan's been around the football for Rutgers all afternoon. That time they go back to the well one more time and try to get that throw behind to the short side of the field. A better play made by Logan Ryan on first down.
Second and 10, 47 seconds. On that scoreboard clock. Lemon inside the 40. Clock is running. Move the chains after they stop the clock. Another first down. They pick up 11.
They may spike it here to stop it, Mike.
It's exactly what they do with 38 seconds.
Rutgers has called their third and final timeout.
Ball resting at the 37-yard line.
Now the Orange will get that down back. There was a timeout well before he spiked the football, so it'll be first and 10. It looks like at the 37-yard lines of the Rutgers Scarlet Knights.
You know, Krautmann, we mentioned the fact coming in he was 23 of 25. We're talking about the field goal kicker. Is in the back of his mind that rush and the fact that it's been like a little leak in the dam up front.
You know what? There might be, but you're not worried about that as a quarterback or as an offense right now. You're worried about getting down and giving him an opportunity. You know, that's a problem he has to deal with on the sidelines and get over. But for Doug Marrone right now, he has to give his kicker an opportunity, and that's up to Ryan Nassib and Van Chu and Alec Lemon and those guys on the football field to get him out there for that field goal opportunity.
As long as 48 for Krautmann. It came against Rutgers. This one's batted down. Clock stops with 36 seconds to go. Big Scott Ballone, third gear starter up front. First at the nose guard position, though. Second down and 10 coming up for Rutgers. There's Krautmann 0 for 2. Missed from 39 and 44.
And Mike, they've been trying to fit the football catch and throw to the outside. But one guy we haven't mentioned too much of is Nick Provo. He's been open on the last couple of downs, more in the middle of the football field. Even though you can get up and spike it, all you need now is probably 7 or 8 yards to have it a little bit easier of a kick for your special teams opportunity.
Syracuse and Rutgers both with no timeouts remaining. Nassib. Wow. Intended receiver was the tight end, David Stevens. He had his paws on it, but Jones came up. Brandon Jones.
Well, this almost went the other way. This is great timing and anticipation by Brandon Jones. He jumped the route to the wide side of the field. Now third and 10 for Ryan Nassib and Doug Marrone.
Nassib and company, 6 of 13 on third down. Picked it up in the second half after only getting two first downs in the first half.
And here comes man coverage again, Mike, with pressure. And they back out.
Overshoots his man. Again, it's Stevens, the tight end, and Marcus Cooper in coverage for Rutgers. 29 seconds to go. It's fourth down. They have to get down to about the 28-yard line for the first down.
Looks like it's out of Krautmann's range, so they're going to keep that offense on the football field and try to convert on fourth down. 29 seconds, 13-13. They miss. Rutgers is going to get excellent field position if they don't convert on fourth down.
Fourth and 10. Everybody in the dome standing. Nassib steps up, and this one's picked off. The harness. He's got a lot of green. Goes back against the grain, and we are going to be heading for overtime. But there's still 15 seconds to go. But now, I say we should be heading for overtime. You got a freshman quarterback, but I guess
you may not
give him the benefit of the doubt, I guess, huh?
You may only need a few yards because right now, Mike, Rutgers has the football on the 34-yard line. It's going to be around a 51 or 52-yard kick as it is right now. Just great awareness by Steve Boharnas. He was playing center field in the middle of the football field. He read the eyes of Ryan Nassib the entire time.
Third interception. Nova comes in. Santee has missed two field goals today. His long is 50. There's number six, Sanu, inside the 30-yard line.
They're well within field goal range now. A great pass on the outside by the young quarterback, Gary Nova, to Sanu, and now they're going to bring out the field goal unit with 11 seconds to try and win this game. Rutgers has been down the entire game, and now they have an opportunity with 11 ticks to win it.
This one from 44. Again, his long is from 50. Santee missed it. Six seconds to go. Santee, 52 career field goals. He's missed three. 51, 47, and 44.
Mike, it's going to be a long Sunday and Monday for whoever wins this game because there's so many mistakes. But if you end up on the losing end of this game, between penalties and missed kicks and blocked kicks and missed opportunities, each team has had a chance to seize the opportunity and win this game, take it from the other team. Now it looks like we're going to go to overtime, and whoever has that chance is going to get extended time to do it.
Spikes it. That's going to be the final play of regulation, and for Syracuse now, they're heading for their third overtime game in 2011. Victories over Wake Forest, victory over Toledo last week, and now they have to go to the extra period again with the Scarlet Knights of Rutgers.
Well, it's been a roller coaster for both sidelines, and head coach Doug Marone on his sideline of the Orange, they've had chances. They've had three chances inside the 30-yard line to put away the Scarlet Knights of Rutgers, and the defense of Rutgers has been able to keep their team in the game.
Let's go back to the first quarter. Miscues, big plays, big hits like that. Tyshawn Davis and a 65-yard return by Anderson.
Scoop and score by Anderson after the big hit by Tyshawn Davis. Does a great job of putting a helmet on the football, and then the one-handed grab by Mohamed Sanu to move the offense of Rutgers in position. And then the lightning in the bottle, the heartbeat of the offense, 29, Antoine Bailey. He's picking him up and putting him down. Another penalty, gets the ball to the 4-yard line where he goes in and scores a touchdown. Big turnover by the secondary, David Rowe for Rutgers after the tip pass. Again, one of the three opportunities the Orange had to really make it a 2 or 3 score game, but special teams has been the story for Rutgers. Tipped balls on extra points and field goal attempts. This one went 60 yards on the block. It was called back, and that set up Nova to Sanu for the touchdown.
And the third pick by Rutgers defense. Hats off to them, because Nassib only had one all season. This is Steve Boharnes, the middle linebacker. Then Santee missed it. And we're headed for overtime. So Syracuse with just 88 total yards in the first half. They got it going a little bit. Bailey goes over 100 again, but missed opportunities.
Well, the turnovers have been the story. Penalties and turnovers have been the story of this game. Only 13 points scored by the offensive and defenses, because you have to add those guys in. They were turning the football over today.
Like, that's a head, that's a tail. What's your call?
Heads.
We call the head. It is a head. You mean offense, defense, or defend the end of the field?
Defense.
You want defense.
So Rutgers wants to see what Syracuse can do offensively. And they'll play defense first.
Mike, it seems like we just did this last week here.
A little deja vu here. There's Rutgers all-time overtime records, 2-4. Syracuse 7-5, 2-0 this season. And Doug Marone, well, he's going to suck it up for another overtime, but he's got to think, boy, miscues.
One of those games where the Syracuse Orange felt like they had opportunities to put this game away, because Rutgers offensively really didn't do too much to hang with it, but defensively was the key. Defensively, they were able to stay in this football game.
Let's update those rules there for you. The coin toss, of course, and Rutgers will be playing defense after winning the toss. Get a possession from the opponent's 25-yard line per overtime until the winner's decided. Play clock only, no game clock, but they have to go for 2-point conversion starting with the third overtime. A week ago, Toledo took it, and Kevin Scott came up with a big INT setting up the game-winning field goal. But this time, Syracuse will have the football first in the overtime.
And if you're Rutgers, you feel pretty good about rolling your defense out there, because they've been turning back the Orange offense every time they've gotten across the 30 or 25-yard line. They've been doing a nice job of putting a picket fence or a wall up to keep them out of the end zone.
Here's Bailey. Finds some running room, and Bailey gets down to about the 15-yard line. Marcus Cooper finally makes the stop. So he picks up 10 on the first play.
It's a Syracuse first down.
Bailey with 102 in regulation, so now 112 for the ball game. Nassib turns, fires, incomplete. There's a penalty flag to Logan Ryan. Might have been a half step behind Van Chu, and he gets flagged.
11 defense. The ball would be put at the spot of the foul. First down.
Ryan is on the back all afternoon, it seems like. That right arm seems like it gets into Van Chu, and you can't definitively see it on that play, but the last couple of times they've tried to run that quick slant, it looked like his right arm is in the back of the receiver, Van Chu, and pulling that arm.
Bailey. Cuts back, a little hop, skip, and a jump inside the 5-yard line for Antoine Bailey. First possession of overtime.
Boy, tough runner in between the tackles. He just needs a crease of daylight. Just give him a little bit of daylight, and Antoine Bailey can jump cut, go north and south through that window. Now they've got the ball, the Orange do, at the 5-yard line.
Bailey again. Down to about the 2.
And Mike, the Orange can get a first down, but it looks like inside the 2-yard line, depending on this spot, they may be third and about a half a yard for that first down. They bring in the bruising back, Jerome Smith. Remember, Bailey goes at around 5'7", 200 pounds. Now they have that big back at 5'11", 215 pounds in there for the Orange.
He gets the call. He might have fumbled the football. Kasim Green says it's recovered by Rutgers.
I believe the official said he was down.
That's Rowe, number 4 underneath the pile there. So number 32, Daron Harmon, the safety, came up to make the initial contact.
Take a look again. Jerome Smith going in those big bodies. Yes, his arm was definitely down on the ground. That was not a fumble. That's a good call by the officials.
For a measurement. So Doug Marone in Syracuse. Third overtime. There's a measurement coming up here. Trying to remain unbeaten at home.
It looks like they may be just short of this first down, Mike.
Big decision coming up here. Take the points or make sure you get a touchdown.
The way this field goal unit has been blocking, it would be a question in your mind whether you want to have Antoine Bailey go in on fourth and short. But Doug Marone's going to send Krautmann out for the attempt.
Well, the crowd here at Syracuse, they wanted to go for that touchdown.
When you're this close, they're not gimmies, Mike. It's almost like the extra point, but when you're on that right hash, it's not an easy kick. Especially when you have him protected solid on the right side for this football game.
He'd missed 2 in his career. He's missed 2 today. This one from 19. He's got it. But Syracuse had to settle for the 3. 16-13. Now Rutgers is back in the driver's seat.
And again, this Rutgers defense and Greg Schiano, who calls the signals for that defense, doing a nice job of keeping Syracuse out of the end zone. So that gives the young quarterback and Gary Nova an opportunity to go down from the 25-yard line, see if they can manufacture at least a tie, but they're looking for that touchdown and the win.
Well, Greg Schiano said he wanted to play Nova at least a series every game. Well, Nova took over, and he's taking over the ball game. If they should win this one, Chase Dodd's going to wake up on Monday, head for practice, thinking, what's going on?
It's been a long series. He's taken over in this football game and done a nice job for a young quarterback, showing poise in the pocket. Nova on the afternoon, 13 of 21 for 118 and a touchdown.
So Krautmann gives Syracuse the 3-point lead, but now Rutgers at the 25, their first play in overtime. Touchdown wins it. Sanu stops, turns, Nova. down near the 15. So Sanu, that's the second time he's throwing the ball here. Picks up 9 on the play. Rashard Anderson wrestles him down to the turf.
I'm sure Frank Cignetti had to get deep into the playbook to get that one. That was specifically drawn up maybe for a two-point play or in overtime to catch the Orange napping, but the Orange did a pretty good job of preventing that from being a bigger play than a 9-yard gain.
Jamison breaks to the outside, cuts back, gets the first down inside the 15-yard line. Needed one, picks up 2 before Torrey Ball makes the stop.
The guy with the sure hands is number 6, Mohamed Sanu and Joe Martinick. Those guys have done a nice job throughout the game, but one guy that's emerged on the outside has been Pratt, number 7, the redshirt sophomore. But Sanu's the guy outside. Martinick in the backfield, Sanu on the outside.
Nova, Martinick, the fullback, comes out of the backfield. They're down to the 10-yard line. Dan Vaughn pushes him out of bounds. Martinick picks up 4.
Smart, safe call on first down for your young quarterback. Get it into a guy who's got sure hands in the flat. You're rolling towards him, so it's a nice throw. You have Joe Martinick in your vision the entire time.
Jamison down near the 5-yard line. Philip Thomas makes the stop defensively for Syracuse.
And Mike, we talked about the size of these Rutgers wide receivers. If any time I want to throw a jump ball, I want to move Brandon Coleman or Mohamed Sanu or Timothy Wright. If they get man-to-man on the outside, why not take a chance and throw it up to one of your big receivers? If you get that matchup you're looking for, give it an opportunity for your big guy to go up and get the football.
Wow. Was that Greg Schiano running down the sidelines calling the timeout?
Called the timeout.
Yes, it was.
He was almost out to the hash.
And he might have.
I think he was running a 4-4 or 4-3.
He might have got a hamstring pull on that one. He started about the 30.
Boy, did he take off.
30-second timeout.
I glanced down. I thought maybe a fan got down on the field or something, and here's the head coach. But again, let's go back to the size of the wide receivers that this Rutgers football team has. A big advantage as far as size.
Well, if you're going to get your matchup, Sanu's the smallest guy. He's the most sure hands on the outside, but Coleman at 6'6", a tight end at 6'6". You have Wright on the outside at 6'4", Harrison at 6'3". You have a young quarterback that has done a good job of throwing the football up the length of the football field. And now you have Sanu on the outside and number 7, Pratt, to the wide side of the field.
So Harrison and Coleman left the game. They're on the sidelines in a big third down play. Interesting call. He lines it up for the fourth down, and about a yard, maybe a yard and a half shy.
Mike, I believe they had a pass play called on third down, and Greg Schiano went, called the timeout, and came back and tried to run the football to give them the option of doing some other things on third down. But now it's a fourth down situation, and I don't see
Santee
coming out.
This is interesting. This is some intestinal fortitude here, John Congemi. The ball just inside the 5-yard line.
Well, the way Greg Schiano ran down that sideline, I'm not surprised about this.
Delayed offense, 5-yard penalty.
Now they have to kick it. The big thing is, you know, the special teams for Rutgers have been making plays all day. Can Syracuse turn the tide and create some pressure on this special team's opportunity and get a hand up and deflect this ball or make it go wide?
27-yard field goal attempt.
San Santee from 27. And the kick is through, so San Santee ties it at 16, and we're headed for overtime number two. So Rutgers trying to snap a six-game skid, a two-game skid against the Syracuse Orange.
It's been a heck of a football game, and both kickers coming through in overtime. Short field goal opportunities. San Santee splits the uprights, but both offenses had fourth and very short. They elected to kick the field goal, which was the smart thing to do. Now Doug Marone will get right back on defense. It looks like they may change ends for the second overtime.
So Syracuse had the ball to open up the first overtime. So Rutgers will take the ball to open up the second overtime. Now it's Doug Marone and Scott Schaefer. It's their turn to try to force the field goal and see if they can get a touchdown and go home.
How impressive is it to have your young freshman quarterback enter the game in a difficult situation, being down, I believe it was 13-3 when he came into the football game. Now you take a look and you've grown up. You might have to shave between overtimes because it's 16-16 and he's no longer young anymore. He has to come out and everybody's looking at him to make plays. And he's done a great job in the pocket. He's really gotten guys in and out of the huddle, thrown the football with authority, taken some chances, but come through pretty good so far.
As you mentioned, over 100 yards and a touchdown. He came in just 7 of 20 for 116 yards for the season, 14 of 22. 122 yards, that's just under 64%. So the Scarlet Knights open up the second overtime here inside the dome. Nova rolls right. Carrizola, the big tight end. It's going to be incomplete. He was out of bounds. He ran out of real estate.
Again, the quarterback extends the play, let his wide receivers and tight ends try to find some zones that are open in that secondary, but a better play by the defensive back, Wilkes, forcing that big tight end out of bounds. Now second and 10, ball to 25.
Yeah, second and 10, you want at least 7 or 8 on this play, don't you?
You may look for your fullback in the short flat again, try to get an easy pitch and catch.
He's going deep. And he was looking for number 81, Mark Harrison. He got turned around. And so now Rutgers with a third and 10.
And Mike, just as head coach Greg Schiano has dialed it up for his defense, Scott Schaefer, the defensive coordinator for the Orange, is he going to bring pressure? Rutgers may go empty on this. They have one back in the backfield. So they have the size on the outside with those wide receivers.
Sanu is at the top of your screen. Coleman at the bottom. Blitz. Fourth down. Aneta came from the outside, number 39, and Brandon Sharp was in there again as well. Four sacks now for Syracuse. 12 on the season. Most importantly, it's fourth down, and San Santee is facing a 47-yarder here.
Good pressure in the pocket. Now all the pressure on San Santee.
Plenty of leg. And he's got it from 47 after missing from 44 earlier in regulation. But the silver lining for Doug Marone is they forced the field goal. Now they can go after the touchdown and the win.
That's a great job by San Santee. Three plays going backwards, it seemed like, for Rutgers and head coach Greg Schiano. But San Santee does a good job. The first lead of this football game comes in the second overtime, 19-16. Rutgers has that three-point advantage because of the leg of San Santee. We talked about the patience of the veteran quarterback, Ryan Nassib, in the fourth quarter being patient, but that was one big interception coming down the stretch Now can he rally from that and either get his field goal unit out to tie it or try to get a touchdown to win it?
First play for Syracuse in the second overtime. They trail by three. Oh, nice play, Stevens. And he picks up five on the play, but Nassib but turned with the victory. Bailey in the backfield behind Nassib, who's under center. Bailey. There's a fumble. And if this is recovered by Rutgers, what a way it is. Indication Scarlet Knights have won this football game. If this stands, that's five turnovers.
Wait a minute, they're calling everybody off.
I'm pretty sure they're going to go upstairs. Jack Kramer's going to have to decide this by looking at the video. If it stands as a fumble, it'll be the second one by Bailey today.
Antoine Bailey going to the short side, cuts it back. Looked like he had some room. 's hard to tell if that ball was on the ground first or somebody got a hand on it. It looks like the ball may have came out early. Edmund Larea may have got that arm inside. Number 30 in white. There's the arm on the football. And the second guy there looks like he may have gotten the strip. Jamal Merrill. There's the first tackler for Rutgers. There's the ball. It's out early. But was his knee down, Mike? That's the next question.
Well, that's a decision that Jack Kramer is going to have to make up in the booth. Tom Tomczyk, a referee.
You definitely see the ball come out from that end zone shot angle. But what we can't tell right now is if his knee was on the ground. There's the ball out.
Well, if the ruling is confirmed or if it stands, the Scarlet Knights are going to snap a six-game road skid and a two-game skid against Syracuse.
Ball's out. I think it's out in the knee, still in the air. I think that's going to be a fumble. It's going to be confirmed. And it looks like Rutgers is going to win this in double overtime.
View. The ruling on the field is confirmed. The game is over.
That's it. Rutgers goes on the road, snapping a six-game road skid. They didn't get their first touchdown until the fourth quarter. Their first lead in the second overtime, but they head back to Piscataway with the W.
A very tough contested football game by both teams. Rutgers, as you said, Mike, they find a way to hang around with their defense. Credit their defense because they kept them in the football game the entire first half when Syracuse had opportunities.
As we take another look at our Liberty Mutual play of the game, Antoine Bailey over 100 again, but his second fumble.
Edmund Larea was first there at the linebacker position. You're going to see him flash, number 30 in white. He has the first hit. And then Jamal Merrill on the bottom of the pile ends up with the football. Antoine Bailey, you can't say enough about the way he played. He ran tough in between the tackles, but a tough hit there. Hand on the football. Ball comes out.
And Greg Schiano goes to 3-1 this year. And you talk about the miscues and the penalties for Syracuse. This is going to be one tough pill to swallow for Doug Marrone.
It really is. The opportunities that the offense had inside the 25-yard line, three opportunities in this game, they came away with 0 points, and that's going to be the thing that they're going to look at tomorrow and Monday of why they lost this football game.
So Antoine Bailey fumbled on the first play of the game, and Bailey fumbles on the last play of the game, and Rutgers gets out with the victory. Once again, our final score, the Scarlet Knights of Rutgers, 19-16 over Syracuse in double overtime.